Can you hear me?
Yes, sir, you are audible.
Yes, okay. So we are in the end of the season of tax audit report, and still we are going with the VCM for today's session on company law and critical aspects. I welcome all the members who have joined this VCM. Kindly rise for the institute motto.
यशस्सुप्तेषु जाग्रति यशस्सुप्तेषु जाग्रति कामं 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 पुरुषो निर्विमाणः निर्विमाणः तदेव शुक्रं तदेव शुक्रदब्रह्म तदब्रह्म
Thank you, all the members. Today, video virtual series on company law and its critical aspects, day two. CA Vikas Jain will be the speaker for the session. I think most of the members know him very well. He does not require any introduction, but this is the formality that we have to complete. So I am going with the experience and qualifications held by CA Vikas Jain. He is a practicing since 2003 in various areas such as insolvency and liquidation matters, company law and LLP matters, auditing, corporate social responsibility, and management consultancy services. He has conducted various seminars and lectures at various forums, including CPA study circles of ICAI, ICSI, etc. He has done BCom from Jai Narayan Vyas University. He is a fellow member of ICAI. He is a registered insolvency professional. He has a complete diploma in information system audit DISA. He is also a certified arbitrator. He has been a mentor and guide to young professionals and helping them in setting up a good career path. If I talk about his key positions held, he is a regional council member during 2019 to 2020. Ahmedabad branch, he has occupied many positions during 2017 to 19 managing committee member, 2016-17 chairman, 15-16 vice chairman, 2014-15 secretary, 2013-14 treasurer, 2010-11 vice chairman of GVMCS committee. I think no position is left for that Vikas bhai.
Kalse ave Chintan bhai, thoda karna chahiye.
So with this, I hand over this session to Vikas bhai to take us further for the critical aspects of the company law. Thank you.
Thank you, Chintan bhai. Yes, thank you very much, all the participants and members of Ahmedabad branch. And I also could see from the list of participants, places, members from other places also, like Palanpur and all, have also joined. It's always great to share or exchange knowledge with the members of our fraternity. So dealing with the deadlines that have been coming every now and then, or maybe every other day. So once we conclude with the or complete with the income tax returns, then immediately comes our tax audit, and 15th is the tax audit, and literally for Gujarat, 13th is the last date, because on 14th and 15th, because of Uttarayan, it would be very difficult to come for the work. So friends, the participation today is very encouraging. I could see almost 150 persons have joined this. And friends, before we come to the subject proper, I would like to discuss one or two things at least. One is this extension that is badly actually needed by all of us, and we have not been able to get the extension what it was desired. But friends, somewhere or other, we have to draw a line, and we need to understand actually. All would agree with me that those clients who have come to us well in time, we could have completed the work for them. But only those who have come in the last 2-3 days, or in the maybe last 4-5 days week, only for them only we were not able to complete the work. So we need to tell our client that they need to be disciplined. It was pandemic is one thing, but everybody will agree that the major issue was the lack of discipline on the part of the client. They people are not coming on time, and ultimately we need to suffer. So I've seen few of the firms, even in Ahmedabad also, they are having an approach kind of thing, like those who come for, if we see that the regular tax audit date is 30th of September, then those clients who come well in time, maybe say by 31st of August, then they would be charging the normal fee. And thereafter, if somebody comes by say 15th of September, there would be a premium of 50% on the fee, whatever they are. And thereafter, if they come by 23rd of September, means a week before, they would be charging 100% premium. So 100 plus 100. So that would be the fee amount. And after 23rd, they are not accepting the client also. So friends, we all need to understand, because we need to work overtime. Our employees need to work overtime. We have to shed out extra resources for all such kind of things. So if we demand something extra from our client, there is absolutely no harm. And the client also can take a well-informed decision whether they want to give out extra or they want to come on time. So it's up to them. So this will not only remove the trouble that we do have. And friends, ultimately, there is something goes wrong with our audit reports or something like our attestation function, then believe me, whatever that is going to happen with the client, maybe some penalty or whatever. But for us as a professional, it is a big blot on our career. If there is a black spot, I would say, if you have done something wrong or if something goes wrong unintentionally. Gone are those days when there was no automation, no electronic systems were there. So nothing was happening. But now what happens? Everything is available on the click of the button. And if something wrong is there, that would surface very soon. And the regulators are also won't take the things easily. They like, if normal businessman, he can always take the plea of the ignorance. But so far as we chartered accountants are concerned, we can't say that I am not aware of the provision or something like, or because of the pressure, this mistake has crept in. So that is not possible on our part. So believe me, friends, we need to be very, very, very serious on these issues, because if we have to impart quality, ultimately that is the thing that is going to help us in the long run. And if you want to have or ensure quality, then we need to give ample time to the assignment. And so as to give the ample time, the another thing that is most important is the fee. You all will agree that we all are facing or feeling the same pain, I would say, because what happens, the fee level that was there maybe 10 years back, the same fee level remains even today only. So there is literally no increase in our fee level or whatever that we have been doing. So the reason are, there are n number of reasons that are there. Maybe one is the we sometimes feel that the compliance area or the area compliance practice is very much overcrowded sphere. So because of that, we have not been able to increase the fee, and forget about increase. Maybe for the last 10 years, we have been doing the same fee, or sometimes the fee is even going down only, because the client would come and say, okay, you charge is too high, and some other CA is ready to charge for even lesser amount. So this is a very, very serious concern. Ultimately, if we are not able to excel or grow in our profession, then the time would be very tough. And especially for the, I would say, the younger generations and all, I would suggest that we need to think something different from the routine areas like that of GST or income tax, because this is already an overcrowded sphere and nobody wants to pay for the compliances. So there are n number of other opportunities that are coming for all of us, like that of insolvency, maybe, or valuations, or maybe there are n number of other opportunities that are there. So we need to think that we need to get out of this and do something different. But the most important thing is we need to hone our skills. If the skill is not there, skill set is not there to the mark, then we are going to face the problems. So maybe because of the automations, artificial intelligence that are coming in, and so many other softwares, availability of softwares, etc. I would say I fear and I doubt if the routine or compliance practice will be there in the years to come. You might have seen so many GST returns or income tax returns. They are always almost, I would say, auto-populated with few informations. This can be done. And in the times to come, maybe after 5 years or 10 years down the line, I am sure this practice of compliance will go away. So we need to think something different so as to be having better opportunities for all of us. So with this thought, I would request, especially all the chartered accountants who are the senior members, and so please let us have the handholding of the youngsters and the new one, and tell them that how we can grow in our profession. This will definitely help us to build a better profession for all of us. So today, the topic that has been allotted to me, so me and Panil Bhai, we have been discussing about a Companies Act series that we actually wanted to do. The reason was, when it comes to statutory audit, and we have seen a lot of mistakes are there in the audit reports. Frankly, though I'm on a public platform, but I'm being in the fraternity, I feel that it is very much important and necessary for all of us that we need to discuss on this, that there are a lot of mistakes are surfacing in the audit reports that are being prepared by us. So that thing, we need to take it very seriously. And if we are not able to do justice with them, those kind of audits, then really we are going to face trouble. And many disciplinary and all these cases are being filed against the chartered accountants, and especially the one, they would be the advocates, or when they are filing the cases or something, they would be finding of the loopholes in the audit reports that we have signed. So we need to be very, very serious, especially with the statutory audits that are being signed. And friends, the other thing... So other thing that I see is in this season, when the season is about to be over, I have received, having many friends, I received a lot of communications from others that there is a lot of problem in seeking NOC. So when the chartered accountants are to be replaced by one auditor is to be replaced by another auditor, the provision or the code of ethics says that no chartered accountant should accept the auditor audit without communicating with the previous auditor. So the provision is without communicating. So it is not NOC, but what is more important is communicating with the earlier auditor or the previous auditor. But please, may I request all the members to be please on the mute? Sezad bhai. Yeah, hello. Am I audible?
Yes, sir, audible.
Okay, thank you, sir. Thank you. Sezad bhai, I request to please put the others on mute. Yeah. Thank you. So what I was discussing about the NOC, see, many of the chartered accountant friends, they come to me and they say, pehla CA humne NOC nahi aapta, kya problem che, te problem che. And when we go through the papers, when we discuss all these things, what I've seen is lot of discrepancies are there. One, the communication that are there with the client, the communications with are there with the auditor. So sometime
because the report aaj karvano se thai gyo aaj is karyo
sawal apne baitha de na bana. May I request all the members to please
amar jo ga
ji 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 ji
hello yeah. So what I've been discussing, yes. Hello. Yeah. So while going through the various communications between the auditors and the previous auditors, or the communication between the previous auditor and the client, I've come across many such this kind of communications, I would say, which could lead the CA to trouble, which actually can invite trouble and we'll be having problems. Why I'm saying so? Sometime I see that the CA says that my fee for the audit work and the accounting work both is pending. So we all understand that being a CA, being auditor of that company, he cannot do the work of the accounting. That is not possible. That is a sheer violation of the code of ethics. Or there would be many such communications. This is just a simplest example that I have shared with you. So we need to be very, very clear while communicating with the client. And see why all these things have come up. This is when there is a conflict between the client and the auditor, then it is fine. We become vigilant and all this. But in the previous years, when we are having very good relations with the client, we never bother about all these things. And we write everything on the mail and all these things. So that creates a problem. It is not today what we are communicating. The client tomorrow may come out with the discussions or the communications that we had, which have been shared on the electronic mode or some other such means. And they'll come out with those documentations and they'll say that, see, you have done this. And literally in minimum 8 to 10 cases in the last 1 month, I have seen such kind of things. So, and there will be n number of other communications that have been put on the mail without thinking twice that what repercussions such kind of things may have in future. So friends, we need to be very much professional. We need to be very much careful before communicating with the client, whether actually what we are writing may not create any kind of problem for us in the times to come. So just howsoever good relation, this advice is howsoever good relations we might be having with our client, but when we write anything over the mail or anything we give in the documented or written form, then friends, please be vigilant, be careful. And for that, we must also know our code of ethics and engagement standards very well, because these are the two things that are going to help us in case any trouble is there. And if you have not been able to take care of the code of the ethics and engagement standards, then I believe me, nobody would be able to save us, howsoever strong relations or whatever we do have, but no one would be able to take us out from those kind of trouble. So it is very much important now, since after 15th, everybody would be relatively free or bit free, I would say. CAM to koi dio free thata nahi, but still they would be bit free. So please have such kind of or start developing practice of reading those code of ethics and engagement standards. These are very, very, very much important. And this is important not only for the young chartered accountants or the senior chartered accountants, but for all. And another one is SQC, that is the standard or quality control. So far as our institute is there, only we have SQC1, that is one standard on quality control, SQC1. And that is equally applicable to smaller firms, bigger firms, proprietary concerns or partnership firms even. So friends, please go through that. That will also help us a lot. So now let us come to the subject proper, and I'll start sharing my screen. Just a second, please.
Vikas sir, please unmute sir.
Sorry, I kept myself on the mute. Sorry. Yeah. So, friends, today I have been allotted with two topics. One, the comparison between the companies and the LLP, and the another topic is annual compliances under the Companies Act. So, first topic that I am taking today is company versus LLP. I'll also include the partnership wherever possible or needed. Okay. So, but before this, I would like to discuss the two important things about LLP. So, before this, I would like to talk about the two important aspects of LLP, and which I have delivered so many lectures on LLP, and I still believe that there are a lot of confusions about this. That who can be a partner in an LLP? Friends, the definition is very clear. When it goes to this LLP Act, in Section 5, it has been mentioned who can be partner. Any individual or a body corporate can become a partner in LLP. So individual, we all understand. I should not speak much on that. But any body corporate. And so far as the body corporate is there, in Section 2, Clause D, it has again been defined in the LLP Act that body corporate means any LLP registered in India or outside India, or any company registered in India or outside India. So friends, it is very, very much simple that only an individual or a LLP registered in India or outside India, or any company resident company registered in India or company registered outside India. So these are the total five categories who can become a partner in LLP. So friends, many times I receive a question that whether an HUF can be a partner in LLP. So it is very clear, an HUF cannot be a partner in LLP. A trust cannot be a partner in an LLP. A normal traditional partnership firm, that cannot be a partner in LLP. So the test is very simple. Only an individual or an LLP registered in India or LLP registered outside India, or a company registered in India or outside India. So barring these five categories, whatever it comes to you, straightforward, you can say no, it is not possible. So this we need to take care of while deciding whether LLP can be created with such kind of persons or not. Friends, if we talk about the governing law, in case of a company, companies, we all understand that are governed by the Companies Act 2013, whereas limited liability partnerships, these are governed by the LLP Act 2008 and also the rules made thereunder. In case of partnership firm, it is governed by the Partnership Act 1932. So far as the registration is concerned, we all understand that may it be company or may it be LLP. Registration is must. Without registration, this will not come into existence. Wherever, if we talk about the partnership firms, registration is optional. So whether you register or not, that is up to you. But if you are an unregistered partnership firm, then we do not have the right to sue. That is the only disadvantage in case of a partnership firm. Yes, we can be sued, but we are not having any right to sue other party. Creation. So company and LLP both are created by the law. Distinct entity. So company is a separate legal entity under the Companies Act. At the same time, LLP is also a separate legal entity under the LLP Act 2008. Whereas if we talk about the partnership firms are not any separate legal entity, but they are simply representing the partners, the bunch of the partners. They represent that partnership firm, that's it, but they do not have any separate legal entity. Well, choice of name. In case of a company, we can have different names of our wish, but subject to rules and conditions. And in case of a limited company, it has to end with the word limited. In case of private limited, with private limited company, same. In case of LLP, that there would be a suffix of limited liability partnership or LLP, but the name would be subject to availability. But in case of partnership firms, normally the people just can draft the deed, print it on the paper, and have the name of their own choice. This is what the myth is. This is what we understand. But again, at the same time, trademark is equally applicable to all. We need to ensure that that name should not be registered trademark of any other person or organization. Because though there is no direct restriction on the partnership firms to have such kind of name, because we do not need to have any kind of name approval or something, and we print the name of our own choice. But the thing is, if tomorrow the other party, who is actually the registered owner of the trademark, they come forward and file a complaint against us, then being in partnership firm or even in proprietorship firm also, we can be in trouble. So we need to ensure that no such thing is there. Then cost of formation. In case of companies, the cost of formation is a bit higher. It was earlier, but now though I would say cost of incorporation is almost similar in case of companies and LLP. There is no such major difference. And in case of partnership firm, mainly the stamp duty, that is the only cost. There is no other cost, because we chartered accountants are very much happy, or more than happy, to do it for free. We never charge any fee to our client for drafting the partnership deed. So, but then this practice needs to be done away with. We should charge for everything that we give to our client. Perpetual succession. So this is again a similarity between a company and LLP. No matter, all the members of the company may get changed. Whosoever the members were earlier, let's say there were A, B, C, and D, four shareholders of a company. Thereafter, maybe A and B, they have sold their shares to C and D. So they extinguished to become the member A and B. Now C and D are the sole members of the company. Still, or maybe let us say that A, B, C, and D, all four of them have transferred their shares to other persons, but still, those new person E, F, G, and H, they can continue, but the company will remain in existence. That will have a perpetual succession irrespective of their members. And same is the case with LLP. Maybe, for example, A and B are the two person, they became partner, they started the LLP, and subsequently they retired, and C and D are admitted to the LLP. Still, there will be a perpetual succession irrespective of the partners may come and go. Charter document, in case of companies, it is memorandum and articles of association, whereas in case of LLP, this is an LLP agreement. So friends, again, here I would like to discuss something about the LLP agreement, because LLP agreement is the essence, I would say, of any LLP. So friends, we should always avoid that cut, copy, paste kind of approach or style, I would say, while incorporating any LLP. Friends, because what happens, if we talk about Schedule 1 in the LLP Act, so Schedule 1 is something which deals with 13 clauses almost, and it is being laid down in the Act, it is mentioned in the Act that if the agreement is silent on any portion, then that Schedule 1 would be applicable. So for example, if you do not have any LLP agreement, in absence of the LLP agreement, Schedule 1 of the LLP Act would be applicable. And Schedule 1 gives almost 13 points. So it is mentioned, like, for example, a few of the points I would like to discuss for the benefit of the members, that it is mentioned in the LLP Act that if the agreement is silent, then all the partners would be having equal profit sharing ratio. So maybe, for example, in an LLP, one partner might have contributed 1 crore rupees capital, another partner might have contributed 10 crore rupees capital, and the third partner might have contributed only 10,000 rupees the capital. But if in the LLP agreement, it is not mentioned about the profit sharing ratio, then irrespective of the capital that they have contributed, the profit sharing will be equal. So the company or the LLP would be in a great trouble because of this, because there would be disputes amongst the members and all there. So we need to be aware of. So Schedule 1 is very, very much important. So while drafting the agreement, LLP agreement, we must ensure that the points that are there in Schedule 1 must be negated. So whatever that is there in the Schedule 1, we need to know very well. And the things which we don't want in our LLP, we should at least counter those clauses of Schedule 1 in our LLP agreement, so that the LLP agreement will supersede those clauses in Schedule 1. So And another important thing is, just like the Partnership Act here or Partnership Deed, if we are not mentioning about the working partners and all these things, or the remuneration and the interest availability, then this will also be not allowed as per the Income Tax Act. So friends, here again, I would like to touch upon another important aspect, that is about the designated partner. This is again very, very important. What I've seen is people normally compare the designated partners with the working partners. So in every LLP agreement, they mention about the designated partner and do not mention anything about the working partner. So we need to be very much cautious about this, because there is no word called designated partner in the Income Tax Act. And in the entire agreement, if we mention designated partner, but nowhere we mention working partner, and in the remuneration side also, if we mention that to the designated partner, we would be giving this kind of remuneration, then tomorrow there may be a problem so far as the Income Tax Act is concerned. So friends, first let us understand the concept about the designated partner and working partner. So working partners are those who are actively engaged in the business or profession of the LLP, and they are taking active part in the business. So this is all about what the designated, this working partner. But when it comes to designated partner, this term has no reference other than what it has been mentioned in the LLP Act. And in the LLP Act, designated partner means the partners who are responsible for the compliance of the LLP Act. Okay, so the designated partners are the partners who would be responsible for the compliance of the LLP Act. That is what, see, tomorrow if there is a default with the LLP Act, for example, if the Form 8 is not filed or Form 11 is not filed or some other defects are there or defaults are there, then those designated partners would be the responsible partners. I can compare it with the directors in the private limited company or a limited company, because it would be the officer in default. So directors would be the first person who would be liable or held responsible for the defaults. Same is the case in case of LLP. Those designated partner would be the partners who are responsible for the default. So in a LLP, I would say, just let us assume or understand that there are four persons total, four partners, A, B, C, and D. Out of these four partners, A and B are designated partners, but at the same time, the working partner are only C and D. Is this possible? Any views from the members in the chat box? Any view on this? See, this is possible. This is possible. Yes, Tejas Bhai just said yes. So this is very much possible, because This all depends upon the LLP agreement. If in the LLP agreement we mention that A and B would be the designated partner and C and D would be the partner who are responsible for who would be the working partner, then it is C and D who would be responsible as a working partner, and A and B would only be the designated partners. So it all depends upon that, what we have mentioned in the agreement. That is why I have said that agreement is most important thing. There may be a situation wherein the designated partner will not be the working partner. So A and B are designated partners, whereas C and D are the working partners. So this is a possible situation. There may be a possibility in the LLP agreement you mentioned that A and B are the designated partner and C and D are the partner who can operate the bank accounts. So this is the beauty of the LLP agreement. We can design it like this. So A and B, though they are the designated partners, but they cannot operate the bank accounts, because the LLP agreement doesn't give them the power, and the power lies with C and D. So everything is possible. This is all about how we perceive any situation, how we conceptualize the idea, and how we draft the LLP agreement. So it is absolutely up to our wisdom. There is no bar in the LLP Act. The only thing that we need to keep in mind is designated partners are not the working partners unless or until they are mentioned as the working partner in the LLP agreement. Okay. So we should not let that, like, if it is a designated partner is mentioned, if it is designated partner, so it is fine. No, we have to separately mention them as the working partner. So this is very, very much important. So friends, I hope that it is very much clear between what is designated partner and what is a working partner. So because I've seen in many cases, this kind of mistake, and this may create problem to us as well as to our clients. So we have to be very clear. One, who can be partner in LLP? That is very, very much of importance. Paramount importance, I would say. Another thing is about schedule one that is there. And the third thing is difference between the designated partner and the working partner. It is not necessary that all the designated partner will be the working partner. No, not necessarily. So we need to address this in our LLP agreement. Then common seal. So common seal is nothing, but it denotes the signature of the company. And earlier, every company was required to have a common seal that was mandatory. But with new companies Act 2013, it is not mandatory. It is optional. Same is the case with LLP. They if they wish to have a common seal, they can have. And if they do not want to, they may not have. That's it. So far as the formalities of the incorporation are concerned, we all understand that various formalities are required to be done with respect to incorporation. Forms are to be filed. But now, of late, the process has been made so simple and the formalities and the documents have been reduced. In between, before some time, lot many formalities more were required to be done. Earlier, it was very easy. Thereafter, some, I would say, long list of formalities was required to be done. But now, again, it has been rationalized to a greater extent. And so far as the LLP is concerned, again, is very, very simple. You reserve the name, you file the incorporation document, form one, form two, it was like that. Now it is run and all this. So thereafter, immediately LLP is incorporated, and thereafter form three and four, in which the agreement and all these designated partners and all informations are to be given. And that has to be done post incorporation. By form number two, the LLP is already incorporated, and thereafter we have to file these three and four within 1 month of the incorporation. Time required is okay, fine. Now it depends. Legal proceedings, both a company as well as LLP, both are the separate legal entity, and they can sue, and both can be sued as well. Foreign participation, again, foreign nationals can be a member in a company. There is no restriction on that. The only thing is there must be minimum one director who must be resident in India. And same is the case with LLP. Foreign nationals can be partner in LLP. Only requirement is there must be minimum one designated partner who must be resident in India. So friends, this concept of one resident designated partner that came first in LLP, and in the Companies Act 1956, there was no such concept of having minimum one resident director in India. But subsequently thereafter, there were lot many cases where there were the people who were from foreign countries, they were incorporating the company, and post this incorporation, there were some business and some fraud might have taken place, or some tax evasion was there, but nobody was there of whom the government could have caught the hold of. So this particular thing was thereafter brought in. And now, even in case of a company also, there must be minimum one partner who must be resident in India. So far as the FDI is concerned, foreign direct investment, earlier it was the rules were very stringent with respect to LLP, but now they have also been eased out to a greater extent. Okay, so in most of the cases it can be brought in without any permission under automatic route. Now the companies and LLPs are at par so far as this particular thing is concerned. Earlier they were just one step low in the pedestal, the LLPs were, I would say. So the number of members in case of company, in case of a private company, we all understand that yes, earlier the maximum number of member was 50, but now subsequently that was increased, and now ultimately it is maximum 200 members can be there in case of a private company, but in case of, and minimum is 2, and in case of a public company, minimum can be 7, maximum can be any number. So far as the LLP is concerned, friends, LLP again, minimum is 2 partners, but there is no restriction with respect to the maximum number of partners. And yes, we can have 100 partners, we can have 200 partners, there is absolutely no restriction. If we talk about the ownership of the assets, since company is a separate legal entity, so the ownership of the assets is of the company and not that of its members. So for example, if we are having a private limited company wherein Mr. A and Mrs. A, they are the two members and they are the directors of the company, and there is a building in the company, assets in the company, which is a commercial building, I would say. So ultimately, since there are only 2 shareholders, Mr. A and Mrs. A, and they are the directors, they are whole and soul of the company, but still the asset, that building is not the asset of Mr. A and B directly, but that asset belongs to company only. Okay. Since company is a separate legal entity that can own the asset in its own name. And same is the case with the LLP. LLP again being an independent entity separate from its member. It has a separate legal entity. So it can always hold the property in its own name. Yes. Rights, duties and obligations of the partners, if we talk about, then the rights, duties, obligations, etc. in case of a company with respect to the directors are governed by the articles of association. So AOA is there, which is concerned with the internal management of the members, directors, and also the resolution passed by the shareholders in case of general meetings or by the directors in case of the board meetings. Whereas in case of a LLP, the rights, duties, or whatever the obligations may be of the partners, these would be governed by the LLP agreement. And that is the reason I said that LLP agreement needs to be drafted very carefully, because whatever the rights and duties that would be there would always be governed by the LLP agreement. So tomorrow, if we mention in the LLP agreement that Mr. A would only be responsible, or would only be his maximum authority would be to look after the marketing side. So he cannot get involved into the purchase side or something like that. So that can also, that kind of restrictions can also be placed in case of a LLP. So it is up to us. So if some expertise is there of some particular person, then his responsibility can be limited to, or his authority can be limited to that particular role. So this all depends upon us, how we draft that particular agreement. Liability of the members in case of a company, the liability is limited to the amount that has been paid up on each of the share. In case of a LLP, so in LLP also, since the liability is limited, as the name itself suggests, limited liability partnership. So the liability is limited to the extent they have agreed to contribute it. The word in the section 32, which deals with the contribution, it is mentioned the amount agreed to be contributed. So if A and B, they have agreed to contribute 10 lakh each, whatever the actual contribution may be 15 lakhs, or actual contribution may be 5 lakh each, but the responsibility would be limited to 10 lakh each, because that is the amount what they have contributed. So over and above 10 lakh, whatever they have given, that can always be treated as a current capital or maybe unsecured loan from the partners. So this is how, while filing the form 8 and 11 also, this needs to be taken care of, because when we would be filing the form 8 and 11, in form number 8, when it comes to capital, so the actual contribution or the actual amount agreed to be contributed, say for example, is 10 lakh rupees. But because of the remuneration, because of the interest that has been contributed, or maybe because some funds were required in the firm and they have brought in some additional fund, and their contribution goes to 15 lakh rupees. So this will not allow us to punch the data of 15 lakh rupees in that particular form, because as per the form 3 that has been filed, as per the incorporation documents, your contribution is 10 lakh rupees. So there will be a mismatch and it will not allow us. Okay, so whatever the extra amount or the additional amount, that can be always be shown as current capital or partner's loan account. So that has to be done. Then and the liability would always be limited to the amount that has actually been agreed to be contributed. So even if they might have contributed 5 lakh, whereas they have agreed to contribute 10 lakh rupees. So in such case, their liability would be up to 10 lakh rupees. Tax liability, income of company is now taxed at lower rates. Earlier it was at higher rate, but whereas in case of LLP, it is taxed at a flat rate of 30%, just like the partnership firms. Friends, here again, I would like to discuss one thing. LLP for all purpose of tax is treated at par with the partnership firm. So whatever the Income Tax Act that is applicable to partnership firms is applicable to LLP. There is no change except for one change. And that one change is Section 44AD about the eligible SSE. Section 44AD, presumptive taxation, the definition that Section 44AD covers, talks about eligible SSE. So they have categorically mentioned that eligible SSE includes an individual, HUF and a firm, but it does not include LLP. So that is the only place where an exclusion has been given to the LLP. So what does it mean? That even if the turnover of an LLP is, say for example, 50 lakh rupees, but that is not showing that net profit of 8% or whatever, even lower amount that might have shown but still they would not be liable to audit. They can show that amount because 44AD is not applicable to LLP, whereas it is applicable to partnership firm. So this we all need to understand. Then principal agent relationship. In case of a company, members are not the agent of the other member. So if there are four members, A, B, C, and D, so A is not, so A, B, and C, A, B, C, and D are the shareholders of the company. So A would not be responsible for the act of B, same way B would not be responsible for the act of C, D, or A, vice versa. In case of LLP, the partners, they act as the agent of LLP and not as the agent of the other partners. Whereas in case of a partnership firm, the thing is very different. There, every partner acts as an agent of the another partner in case of a partnership firm. That agency relationship is there between all the partners as well as the partnership firm. But when it comes to LLP, the agency relationship is only and only between the LLP and the partner, and not between the partners per se or amongst them. So this is the thing which again help us, because the principal or agent relationship is not there amongst the partners. This is only between the partners and the LLP. So what does it mean? It means that one partner is not responsible for the act of the another partner. So this is very, very much important. This again is very much required to understand the LLPs. Transfer of shares. Ownership is easily transferable by way of transfer of shares. So whatever the shares are, if we want to transfer those shares to others, yes, we'll be ceased to be member of that. In case of LLP also, it is very much possible. Only thing is, it must be very clearly laid down in the LLP agreement about the transfer provisions. If we want to allow somebody to retire from the firm or to get admitted in the firm, what are the various process? So as such, there is no shareholding, but there is the capital that has been contributed. So they may take away their capital, somebody else can brought in the capital, everything is possible. So there may be admission and retirement of the partner, just like in case of partnership firm. But the only thing is, this must be clearly laid down in the LLP agreement. Otherwise, what will happen again? It is mentioned in the Schedule 1 of the LLP Act that no partner can be expelled without a unanimous this kind of thing. So what happens tomorrow if some partner is doing something wrong in the firm, and if we want to show him the door, we want to throw him out of the company or out of the LLP, but it would be very much difficult in the absence of the explicit provision in the LLP agreement. So it is better that it is very categorically and clearly mentioned in the LLP agreement about the expulsion of the member, how members can be expelled if required, or what about the wrongdoings, how if somebody competes against the same LLP within the LLP, and if he competes with the LLP, or if he does something wrong, then what is to be done? So all these things. So friends, this LLP agreement is a very, very thoughtful document, I would say, and that cannot be prepared with a just cut, copy, paste formula. And that is how we can also earn our fee from the client. Because if you're simply doing cut, copy, paste, he's sitting with us in our cabin, and we are having a cup of tea, and by that time the cup of tea is over, somebody from our office, maybe he'll come out with an LLP agreement. So no, that is not going to earn any kind of fee, and that is the reason that creates problem. We should not show the client that, see, we are how extraordinarily intelligent that we can get it done for you in 10 minutes. No. So the approach needs to be changed. Sometime knowingly to take more time is more important than delivering within the minutes or seconds, I would say. Undoubtedly, I do not doubt the capabilities of our members. We can definitely do it. But friends, at times it is important that we understand what are the various requirements of the client. We should sit with them while having a cup of tea. We should discuss why they want to incorporate the LLP. What is the vision with this LLP? What they want to have? What would be the relations between the partners per se? Okay, various things that are required, and all these things which are there in Schedule 1 especially. So how to address those issues? If we can take a brief note of the same, and at least 2-3 days time, we can think, we can also add value by applying our mind that, yes, if these kind of provisions are included in this LLP, this would be even better. So if all such kind of things can be done, I'm sure the client will also honor us and will definitely, because of that value addition, would be giving us better fee, I would say. Then dissolution. In case of a company, it may be a voluntary dissolution, liquidation, or maybe by order of NCLT, okay, or by ROC under section 248, they may strike off the companies, or we may apply for the same, and under section 252, they may, then thereafter they may strike down the registration. In case of LLP, again, it may be voluntary or by the order of the NCLT, or maybe by ROC by filing form number 24. Admission or partner, again, this can simply, admission can be by way of acquiring the shares of the company, whereas in case of LLP, any member can be admitted as a partner in the LLP subject to the LLP Act and the LLP agreement. Cessation, if simply a member or shareholder, he ceased to be a member, maybe by transferring his shares or maybe by death or something like that. In case of LLP, again, a person can cease to be partner as per the provisions of the agreement by giving a notice for the retirement or resignation, whatever. And in the absence of any such kind of things, if he wants to retire voluntarily, then he has to give a prior notice to the LLP of minimum 30 days. So that is required. But again, the situation would be difficult if the LLP wants to throw out somebody because of the wrongdoings that he is doing in the LLP or in the name of the LLP. So in that case, again, agreement would be of paramount importance. In the absence of the agreement, it will be very, very much difficult to do any such kind of thing. So statutory meetings, friends, we all understand that in case of a company, board meetings, general meetings, these are required to be done, and all we have been struggling and we have been discussing about the UDIN provisions because we need to conduct the AGM. So number of days, the 15 days gap that is required to be there with AGM. Again, the AGM notice is minimum 21 days AGM that has to be done. So 31st December, because of the extended time limit that is available to us, the maximum time limit that is available this time for conducting the audit is or for having the AGM was 31st of December. So from 21 days, if we count 21 clear days, so two more days, so 23 days, if we see, then normally 7th becomes the last day ideally, or 8th, whatever, for signing the audit statements of account and signing the notice and all these things. But shorter notice is also possible. And even if somebody has exercised those shorter notice, so that was what a lot being discussed about. So in many companies, because of this AGM has not yet taken place, and there is no provision in the Companies Act whereby this AGM date can be granted extension beyond this 31st December. Even if we apply to the ROC, they are also helpless. They also cannot extend beyond this 31st of December. There is no provision or power in the Act. So that is what the problem is. In case of a company's minimum 4 board meetings are required to be done in each year. Okay, friends. So this is a statutory meeting. This provision in the annual compliance also we need to ensure, because as an auditor, we also need to see the minutes of the board meetings, the minutes of the general meetings that we all must see, and we need to ensure that the provision of the Companies Act have been complied with. So we need to know that minimum 4 board meetings in a year are required in case of a, even in case of a private company, or may it be a limited company or whichever, but only for the small companies or OPC, there may be 2 board meetings in a year, but for rest of the companies, minimum 4 board meetings are required. Okay. And in these 4 board meetings, there cannot be a gap of more than 120 days. So it is not so that in the first quarter, you have done one meeting in the, on the last day of the first quarter, on the first day of the second quarter, you have done one meeting, and then the third meeting would be done in the third quarter last day. So the gap would be increasing beyond 182 days. So that is not allowed. So whenever we are doing the board meetings, that also needs to be ensured that the provision has been complied with of the board meeting. Okay. So that needs to be taken care of. So minimum 4 board meetings in a year, in other than the OPC and small company. In case OPC and small company, minimum 2 board meetings have to be conducted in a year. Okay, these board meetings can also be by audiovisual means, by video conferencing, or any such means. And the only thing is, they should be capable of recording all these things with event date and time. That is more important. And in case there is any failure to conduct such board meetings, then every officer who is in default shall be liable to be penalty with 25,000 rupees per person. So if there are 3 directors, 25 into 3, 75. So we need to ensure that yes, board meetings provisions are complied with. In case of small companies and all these, normally they do not have separate company secretary or something. So we as a chartered accountant, or we need to ensure that yes, these provisions have been complied with, and we need to tell the company that, boss, this is the provision and you need to follow these provisions. You have to ensure that the actual board meeting happens. And also, in case of a new company, the first board meeting should be there within 30 days of the incorporation. That also should be taken care of. But what happens generally many a times, it is not recorded anywhere, or no board meeting is done even after 30 days. Ideally, when we would be opening a bank account or something, or various provisions are required to be done. So the board meeting needs to be called immediately. And actually also that is called, the directors would be meeting, they would be discussing about the various registrations that are required to be taken, or various bank accounts that needs to be opened, or so many other preliminary things that are to be done before the start of the business after the incorporation of the company. But what happens, these things are not documented and it goes out of the mind, and the board meetings are not recorded at times. So that again would be a violation. So make sure that first board meeting happens within 30 days of the incorporation, and thereafter in every year there needs to be minimum 4 board meeting, and the gap cannot exceed 120 days. But in case of a small companies or OPC, there needs to be minimum 2 board meetings, and the gap should be, here the thing is different, here the gap should be minimum 90 days. So otherwise what would happen, the first board meeting will take place maybe at the last day of the 6th month, and the next one would be on the first day of the next 6 month. So ideally it has happened in both the half years, but then the gap is only 1 day only. So that is not doable, that cannot be done. So minimum 90 days gap is required in such circumstances. So that also needs to be complied with and needs to be ensured. So far as AGM is concerned, we all know that every year AGM has to take place in case of a company, and there has been a lot of discussions throughout and everywhere. So I did not discuss much, but for everybody's this information knowledge, everybody is aware of that this year, the end was 31st of December. Otherwise, this has to be done within 6 months from the end of the financial year. That is the maximum time. And that comes to 30th September every year. But because of the extensions that were available this year by the Ministry of Corporate Affairs, by the ROCs, the extended timeline was 31st of December. But unfortunately, still many of the companies are yet to comply with that provision. Okay. So in case that is not possible, then it was required to, they are required to file at least, the AGM should have been conducted in the this provisional files, unaudited accounting statements, financial statements were required to be uploaded. These are required to be uploaded in AOC 4 and AOC 4. So that also needs to be ensured that because of some reasons which are beyond your control, unavoidable reasons, and if the accounts could not be finalized, if the audit could not be done, but at least the AGM should have been conducted in the provisional, unaudited financial statement at least needs to be filed. So the penalties and all this of AGM will not be there at least. So that also needs to be ensured. In case of LLP, there is no such requirement of EGM, AGM or any such kind of thing. But friends, again, if you want to have good corporate governance, I would always advise to my clients that if we want to have good corporate governance, and again, LLP being formed with 2 or more partners. So there may be partners from family or maybe beyond family or friends or whatever, maybe professional these partners as well. So we need to ensure that whatever the decision that has been taken should be documented so as to avoid the future disputes. So I always emphasize on this that made be LLP and there is no statutory requirement of any board meeting or general meeting or minutes, but still every such decision that has been taken in the partners meeting, I would say, so no board meeting, no general meeting, but at least we should have partners meeting, and we should try to record these minutes of the partners meeting and should take the signature of all, and also should circulate the minutes as well. So this healthy practice will save not only the clients, but also the chartered accountants, because I have seen in one of the case what happened in LLP, there were, say, for example, there were 4 partners. There were 4 partners and 2 of them signed the this balance sheets of the LLP and the current, the capital account and everything. Okay. And maybe there was a cash withdrawal or something like that in the partner's current account, and other 2 partners' capital was brought down to a substantial low amount. And thereafter, everything was done. After 6 months, something, those 2 other partners who have not signed the balance sheet, they said, the amount they said it in fraudulently withdrawn. Actually, we have never withdrawn, but whereas in the capital account, you have shown this as withdrawn. So there was a dispute then. They said ki, my capital is still there in the company. However, they have shown as cash withdrawal, but actually we have not withdrawn any cash. So now how to prove? How to overcome that dispute? And they made the chartered accountant, who was the auditor of that company, party to that, that the CA was fraudulently involved in this. And he's in collusion with the other two partners, and he has helped them to siphon off the money from the LLP. And actually my money or our capital contribution that has been taken away, or the amount has been withdrawn. So what to say? Only in practice, if there are unsecured loan from third parties or loans and advances or debtors, creditors, we might be taking those confirmation. But in case of partners, only two have signed, the other two have not signed. So this becomes a big problem. So it is always better to have the signatures, to have the partners meetings, their minutes. And if we can inculcate such kind of healthy practices in our clients, definitely not only the client will be saved from future disputes, but we also would be saving ourselves from such kind of future disputes. This is very, very much important. Annual filing, AOC 4 and all this, I'll discuss while discussing about the annual compliances in the next slides. But for the time being, understand that the formalities are very less in case of LLP. Only Form 8 and Form 11 is required to be filed every year. Audit of accounts, companies are required to get their accounts audited irrespective of their turnover. Even if the turnover is zero, still as per the Companies Act, statutory audit will be required to be done. In case of LLP, there is no such requirement until unless the turnover of that LLP is exceeding rupees 40 lakhs or the contribution exceeding rupees 25 lakhs. So this 40 lakhs, from where this magical figure has come, actually this has come because in the 2008, when this LLP Act came into being, the income tax limit for having audit was 40 lakh rupees. And since then it is 40 lakhs only. From there 40 lakhs to 60 lakhs to 1 crores to 2 crores. But the corresponding changes have not been made in the LLP Act. So even today also the turnover limit in case of LLP remains 40 lakh rupees. But friends, if in the LLP agreement, irrespective of turnover or capital, if in the LLP agreement it is mentioned that the LLP accounts will be compulsorily audited. So just like the companies, even if the turnover is nil or the there is literally no turnover, still the LLP will have to be get its accounts, will have to get its accounts done audited. So that is important. So it depends upon the drafting of the agreement again. If you want to have the audit and if you want to convince our clients that this is literally important because the audit can save you from lot many problems. And friends, now undoubtedly since the audit, this has gone, the limit for the audit has gone substantially high so far as the Income Tax Act is concerned, and faceless assessments coming into picture, I again would recommend, and whenever I talk with the chartered accountants fellow members, I say that we need to tell our client that though the audit is not required as per the statute, but at least they should get their accounts I would say overviewed or reviewed, whatever, by the chartered accountants, so that tomorrow if there is any problem, because when we are doing the audit, many of the problems or issues with the audit, the financial statements, they are addressed, and we help them to comply with the law. We tell them about that this is the law and you need to do this so that you are compliant with the law. So when we are doing such kind of things, or the things are presented in a better manner when the audit is being done from our side. So though it is statutorily not required, but tomorrow if the things are not done in a right fashion, and if there is a scrutiny or something comes up, and in the faceless assessment, it will be almost impossible to address those challenges or to mitigate the challenges. So it is better though audit is required to be done or not, but all the IT returns, especially for the business concerns, if that are to be filed, then they should be reviewed by the chartered accountants, and that will definitely help them to save from such kind of a difficult situation, I would say. So it is up to us how we convince our client, and that would be a win-win situation both for the client as well as for the chartered accountants, because by that way we can add some value to the client, we can get some fee, we can make some money, and at the same time the client will also be saved from the unnecessary penalties just because of the ignorance and all these things. If somebody is not compliant with the law, so undoubtedly nobody can save him, but yes, just because of the ignorance or all these things, small things that which can be cured or which can be rectified, we always can help them. So this is all about how we can convince our clients. whistle blowing, I'll not discuss much because we are also running out of time. It is 5:15 and I'm only left with 15 minutes or 20 minutes, I would say, for the compliance portion. So now the next, this whistleblowing, the only thing is we need to know that this whistleblowing is applicable in case of a LLP. So from the day one, it is there. But in case of company, Companies Act 1956, there was no such provision. But in Companies Act 2013, to certain class of companies, including listed companies, it is mandatory whistleblowing provision. And whistleblowing is something wherein the person, the employees or the partners within the company, if they are aware of any such wrongdoing within the company or the LLP, so if they are aware of any wrongdoing or anything in the company, they can escalate the issue, they can bring it to the notice of the higher authorities, and subsequently they will be immune from the harsh actions of the authorities because they were the one who blew the whistle. Now with this, it brings me to the end of the first part of my presentation. Now I'll jump to the next, this part immediately. Just a second so that I can load that another this presentation on the screen. Yeah. So friends, today I had almost 1.5 hours for this presentation on two topics, and the idea was to have an overview so that we all are aware of what are the things that needs to be done and how a LLP or a company, how we should evaluate or how we should take decision or how we should help rather our client to take the decision that we should go for LLP or a company, I would say. So it was all with that thing in mind. And now this presentation under the compliance is about the Companies Act. Again, this is with the view that I can update or inform all our members what are the various compliances that are required to be done annually. So friends, DIR3, we all are aware of, that was supposed to be done every year 30th September. This year it has been extended up to 31st of December, but date has unfortunately gone now. And for every director who is having a DIN number, the fee of 5,000 is now coming for doing this DIR eKYC. So this DIR eKYC is otherwise very simple. So for the first time, those who are doing for the first time, they have to come with this ID proof, address proof, and all these things are to be submitted. But for the second time onwards, only web KYC can be done. So I'm not getting into the procedure. I'm simply bringing it to your notice about the due dates that are required to be done every year. So those who have not done, so it will be now 31st of, so every year, what the previous 31st March needs to be seen. So those who are having a DIN number, for example, on 31st March 2020, they were supposed to do it by 30th of September 2020 with the extended due date of 31st of December 2020. But now the date has gone, and if somebody wants to file for the year ended on 31st March 2020, then that would be 5,000 rupees per DIN number. And one more thing that needs to be taken care of, it is not only for those who are active directors in the company, but those persons who are having the DIN number as on 31st March 2020, but maybe they are not directly in any of the companies, still they should do it DIR3 eKYC. So those who are having valid DIN number, active DIN number, they should all do this DIR3 eKYC. So for this particular year now gone, and for the next year, that is the year ending on 31st March 2021, the last date would be 30th of September 2021. Now the question comes whether we would be having an extension in this timeline as well, because there are so many directors for whom this is yet to be filed that has not been filed. So friends, as of now, the chances seems to be very, very thin, I would say. But few of us are planning and preparing to file a writ with the High Court, Honorable High Court. And if that gets admitted and then suitable or favorable decision comes in favor, then yes, we may have some hopes. Otherwise, government has categorically said that this date will not be extended. And this 31st of the December was the last date for all these CLSs and all. So Next annual compliance, which again is very important, and which on the first day of this Companies Act series on 9th of this January, we discussed on this. Sri Manoj Hurkat sir, he was there to discuss on this, and he has discussed on this in detail. So I'll not discuss much on this, but the only thing for the benefit of all, that every year for the year ending on 31st of March, by the subsequent of June, we have to file DPT-3. DPT-3 is return of deposit. So friends, one more thing, that there may be some advances from the debtors, there may be some receipts from the shareholders. So though that may be exempted receipts as per rule 21C, but still we need to file a return of deposit. So we need, to my knowledge, almost 90% of the cases of the companies that we do the audit, there would be a possibility or requirement of filing DPT-3. So this needs to be seen very seriously, DPT-3, and the compliance has to be done every year, 30th of June, 2021, in the coming year. For the current year, again, undoubtedly, the last date was 31st of December, the extended date. But if somebody, and I've received phone call from many of the members, ke Vikas bhai ya date vatse ke nahi vade, kem ki aa compliance mare thai to tame bada audit ma padya hata na to rahi gayi che, ave su karvano enu, kem ki audit final na thai tya sudhi DPT-3 file karvano agru thai che. So literally friends, even in the next year, because the audit last date is 30th of September every year, but this needs to be done by 30th of June. So in case of company, our planning should be such that the audits or the accounts of the companies are at least finalized maybe by 30th of June or whatever. How that is, this seems to be very theoretical, but we'll have to make it practical how we do it, because in case of listed companies and all these, anyways, they have been doing it by the month of May and all. So in case of all companies, we need to inculcate again such kind of discipline, that if you are having company boss, you will have to complete it in by any which ways. Otherwise, there again would be problem. And if this 30th June deadline is not met, then again, there would be some penalties and all these additional fees and whatever, whatnot. So friends, we need to ensure that this DPT-3 is filed every year before 30th of June. And again, as I'm telling you, it is not about only the deposits. It is even exempted deposits that you have to file DPT-3, because there would be four radio buttons in the DPT-3 form. It depends whether you are filing it for the exempted deposit, whether you are filing it for the deposits, or you are filing it for the combination of both of these, that is exempted and deposits and non-exempted deposits. So it all depends upon the selection of the radio button, and accordingly it has to be done. But as I'm giving a lot of emphasis on this, that DPT-3 is to be filed every year. So please ensure about this. Then MSME 1 form, this again has to be filed every half year. This is again a very troublesome job for all of us. Firstly, to get the data that who all are the MSME suppliers. So we have to get information. We have to get the information from our clients who all are MSME suppliers and not. So we have to file this form every year, 30 days from the end of the half year. So for 31st of March, 30th April, by that time we would be finalizing all the data, I would say. And the another half year, there is 30th of September. So 30th October is the last date for filing. So 30th April, you have to finalize the debtors and need to finalize all the creditors, I would say, and need to ensure which creditors are MSME and which creditors are not MSMEs. So the creditors are finalized, the unsecured loans are finalized. So that portion of your balance sheet is finalized before 30th of June for sure, because by 30th June, you have to file DPT-3 as well. Okay. So this also needs to be ensured. So how this can be done? So we need to devise an approach that we need to, our client must send an email to all their creditors and asking them about their status, whether they are MSME registered or not, whether they are MSME vendors or not. So if they are MSME, that will have to be shown, and whatever it is that needs to be addressed. Then next comes BEN 2, that is with respect to Benami 2. This is applicable to very few companies, so I'll not discuss much on this. But if any discussion, you can please ask me. I'll be more than happy to share on this. AOC 4 is annual filing of the companies. AOC 4 CFS, that is the consolidated financial statements that is required to be filed. And in certain case of companies, class of companies, we have to file AOC 4 XBRL. So this all depends upon that. And we all understand that this has to be filed within 30 days from the date of AGM. That is, and the date of AGM is included in these 30 days. So if 30th September, say, for example, is the AGM date, then on, by 29th of October, we have to file this AOC 4, not 30th October, 29th of October, because the date of AGM is also included in 30 days from the date of AGM. So 29th of October would ideally be the last date if the AGM is on 30th September. If AGM is on any other previous date, then accordingly it has to be calculated. Okay, so AOC 4 is what is filing of the financial statements with the ROC. Then annual return, MGT 7, annual return has to be filed every year, and this is 60 days from the date of AGM, and this is not including the date of AGM. So here we get clear 60 days. So if 30th September is the date of audit, then 29th of November, because October has 31 days and 29 days of November. So 29th day of November would be the last date for filing MGT 7, and this contains various informations about the company's master, this I would say. So this is annual return of the company. Aakhi kundli company ni anni andar MGT 7 ni andar aayi jai chai, including shareholding pattern and everything. So MGT 8, this is only in case of a listed company, this is required to be filed. A certificate from this practicing company secretary is to be, certificate by a practicing company secretary has to be given. Okay, or other than listed company, again, for certain class of capital that is having a paid up share capital of rupees 10 crores or more, or 50 crore or more turnover, for them also it is required to be filed. And what is this? This form number MGT8, this has to be filed as an attachment of MGT7, that is the annual return. So again, there are 60 days. MGT14, so approval of the financial statements and board report in board meeting, this is only applicable in case of public company. Also, any other special resolutions, these are also required to be filed in MGT14. So this MGT14, what we have been discussing about approval of financial statement, this is an annual compliance that has to be done every year in case of public company. But other MGT14 would only be required in case of the special resolutions that are required to be filed. And within the 30 days of passing of the board resolution with respect to the adoption of financial statement in this given case. Otherwise, within 30 days from the date of special resolution. ADT1, auditor's appointment. So this is the intimation of to the registrar of companies about the appointment of the auditors. And friends, here also so many friends were making some mistake that the auditor was being appointed for 1 year. But friends, with this new Companies Act, we all must understand that the auditor's appointment is not for 1 year, but for 5 years' time. So 5 years' time, it is not optional. It is not voluntary. It is mandatory. So in many of the cases, I've seen that the appointment letter was for 1 year, or it was being said the auditors were filing this ADT1. Now, obviously, the ADT1 is, earlier it was the responsibility of the auditor to file the ADT1. Now it is the responsibility of the company, and it has to be filed within 15 days from the date of AGM. But friends, please ensure that ADT1 is filed for a 5 years period of time in compliance with the law. And also one more thing that we need to ensure, whenever we are accepting any appointment as an auditor, we need to ensure that the appointment is in compliance with the various sections of the Companies Act. For example, in case of a government company, the auditor is to be appointed, there has to be an approval from the central government or something like that in case of the company. And if that particular provision has not been complied with and they have given you the appointment, you accept the appointment and give them the consent, you are in a trouble. So, and in the Code of Ethics, you will see there are a number of cases in this regard wherein the disciplinary action has been initiated against the auditor on complaint. So this is our responsibility to ensure as an incoming auditor that whether our appointment is in compliance with the law or not. Then the indebtedness and all these things also needs to be ensured that yes, these are indebtedness or loan guarantee and all these things. These also needs to be, or maybe investment and all. This needs to be ensured. So not only the Companies Act, the Code of Ethics also needs to be taken care of before being appointed as the auditor of any company. And this has to be filed within 15 days. Then I'll not touch upon the CRA 2, that is the cost auditor and cost audit report and all this, because we are running late. Then PA 6, so past 6 we call it, this is form is for the reconciliation of the share capital. And this is again in case of a public company only, that is within unlisted public companies, I would say that this form is required to be filed. So not necessarily limited company, but any unlisted public company, if you are doing the audit for public companies which are unlisted, this needs to be filed and this needs to be ensured. So this I wanted to bring to the notice of our members. And so far as the Companies Act, we have discussed. So far as the LLP Act, there are only two forms these needs to be filed. These are Form 11 and Form 8. So friends, Form 11, this is about the master data, I would say, and needs to be filed within 60 days of the closure of the financial year, 30th May. This time the scheme was in continuation and we were having a last date up to 31st of December because of that particular scheme. But now the scheme is over. I have received phone calls from many of the members that they have not filed form number 8 and now the penalty that form number 11 and now the penalty that is additional fee that is being levied in from 1st of this June. And the amount that comes is big amount, maybe 20,000, 25,000 rupees in some of the cases, whatever, because you can count the number of days from June. So it's almost 180 days or 190 days have already gone. So it is 18,000-19,000 of that and form number 8 again 6,000-7,000 penalty, whatever it is, additional fee, whatever. So friends, my humble submission over here, the point is that whenever we are filing this form 11 is required to be filed. So 60 days is enough time because this is not contingent or something which is dependent on the financial statement. Even though the financial statement has not been finalized, apna bale accounts tayar na thaya hoy, ema accounts ni to bo budi information aavti j nathi. This is all about the master data of the LLP. So we should ensure that at least this is filed before 30th of May. We need to prepare the list. Every year we are having our list of the clientele we know, and without thinking of the balance sheet and whatever it is, we must ensure that at least form 11 is filed within 60 days. That has to be ensured, and that is how we will be able to mitigate the various deadlines and should also be able to reduce the burden of the additional fee on our clients. So we need to ensure this and we need to take care of this form 11. Again, this is called as statement of accounts and solvency. This needs to be filed within 30 days of the end of the 6 months. So 6 months of the financial year is 30th of September, within 30 days. So before 30th of October, we need to file this. And this is nothing but the profit and loss account and the balance sheet and all these, the financial statements that we have to file with the ROC. So this is all from my side. If any question is there, I'll be more than happy to answer those questions. Maybe if we do not have much of the time with us, but I am available any point of time. You can call me, you can WhatsApp me, you can ask me, you can email me. And by any ways or means, I also would be open to meet the members. That would be a great privilege and pleasure for me. Thank you very much for the patient hearing. And now I would be handing over to Ravi Bhai Jain for the further proceedings. Thank you. Thank you very much. If there are any questions, please do, feel free to ask.
Hi Vikasji.
Hello.
It's a been honored to have been asked to offer a vote of thanks to Vikasji. We have been fortunate to have such a renowned faculty like Vikasji, who gave his detailed analysis on companies provision of companies with LLP and annual compliance under Companies Act 2013 and LLP Act. And I am sure that he will be getting such an insightful session for us in future also. I want to express my generous thanks to Mr. Vikas Bhai on behalf of entire committee. Thank you, Vikas Bhai.
Thank you, Ravi Bhai. Thank you very much. Ravi Bhai, you also need to introduce our today's next faculty, Reema Jain.
1 minute.
Yeah. Ravi Bhai,
Vikas Bhai,
Just hold for a minute. Actually, Rima is joining. I just called her on the phone. She's joining in a minute.
Okay.
Yeah.
Because we, can I call you on your phone? Just 1 minute.
Yeah, yeah, sure. Why not? Yeah, please.
Vikas, sir, there's a question of participants in chat box. Can you please answer?
Yes, pardon? Hello?
There is a question in chat box for you. Can you please answer?
Yeah, yeah, sure, please. Hello?
Yes, sir, a question is copied in your chat box.
Chat box? Just a second. Hold on. Yeah, actually, it has been made of... Okay. In 2017, company had given loans to relative of directors exceeding in industry. Should auditor modify the report? So the report has already been issued then? Hello? Hello? Hello?
Yes, sir.
कौन सेजाद भाई पूछ रहे हैं? हेलो सेजाद
भाई सर, दीपक पिपारिया सर ने क्वेश्चन पूछा है.
किसने पूछा है?
दीपक पिपारिया.
एक मिनट, आवाज नहीं आ रही है.
दीपक पिपारिया सर ने क्वेश्चन पूछा है सर.
जस्ट अ सेकंड, होल्ड ऑन. क्वेश्चन फ्रॉम पार्टिसिपेंट्स. मुकुंद, मुकुंद भरतिया जी का है. हेलो,
दीपक त्रिपाठी सर का क्वेश्चन है सर.
हाँ ठीक है, अब एक काम करता हूँ, इसका टाइप में आंसर यहाँ टाइप कर दूंगा. ये करंट ईयर का है, कौन सा है?
सॉरी सर,
इन 2017, सो दिस इज विद रिस्पेक्ट टू द कंपनीज ऑडिट रिपोर्ट दैट इज बीन इशूड इन 2017-18. एक काम करिए, मैं दीपक जी से मैं फोन पे, आई विल टॉक टू हिम ओवर फोन, आई विल एक्सप्लेन हिम, नो वरीज, बिकॉज आई विल नीड टू हैव सम मोर डिटेल्स अबाउट दिस क्वेश्चन.
हेलो,
मैं भेजूं आपको, व्हाट्सएप करूं वापस? जस्ट एक
सेकंड.
Just 1 minute, she is joining. There is some problem with the link. She is joining in a second. I am speaking to her over phone. I have shared the fresh link with her. Yes, Ravi bhai. Hello.
Vikash bhai. Yes.
She has joined. Rima has joined. So you can please proceed with the session.
Okay. Okay.
Just introduce.
Yes. Just 1 minute. Okay. Welcome everyone. I would like to introduce today's faculty, Rina Jain, taking up the following series for the Companies Act. Rima Jain Duggar is a founder of Liu Jain Legal Advocates and Solicitor, consultant at Liu Jain Advisor. She is a fellow member of Institute of Company Secretaries. She is accounting technician from Institute of Chartered Accountants of India and a law graduate. She is diploma in internal audit from Institute of Company Secretaries and has done BCom with majors in business policies and corporate governance. She is a BCom graduate from Delhi University and had a certificate course in forensic audit and post law. Rima Jain is working in the field of corporate laws and legal drafting and representation services. She has a professional career span of 8 years and a privilege of providing service to clients over a wide range of industry and sector globally. She is on board of listed as well as listed and public unlisted companies as an independent director. She is having expertise of advising, representing and handling matters of NCLT and contract management and negotiation. She has been imperative part of implementation of corporate governance systems and IFSC systems at various organizations. She had an experience in bank audit, SOX compliance and internal audits. She has been imparting training to CAs at CP Awards programs and conference and chartered accountancy students. Welcome her again. Thank you. Yes, Rima, you can.
Thank you so much for the introduction. And Vikasji, always a pleasure seeing you, but this time it's virtually all across. And I think the second time virtually that we have met ever since the lockdown last time happened, and we happened to be a part of the same series then as well. And Ahmedabad is no less than a home ground to me, because I was here when I first presented as a chartered accountancy student, and subsequently, of course, when I've come numerous number of times as a CS talking on company law topics. So I think I'm getting back to my own forum, I'm talking to my own people, and this doesn't seem as if I am dealing with any stranger or talking to any stranger as well. So I think that is because of how Ahmedabad branch has always treated all members, students, and of course all professionals across different professions. Now, as I commence my talk on the topic today, first of all, if I talk about that, okay, we have topics like, say, for example, issue of share capital. We have topics like types of companies. We have topics like alteration of MOA and AOA. I'll tell you very frankly, this is not a topic that can be covered in 1.5 hours. Completely, if I say, complete justice cannot be undertaken. So I have divided this into 3 different segments, as I will not deal with it section-wise. Point number one. Point number two, say when I'm talking about types of companies, I will tell you, okay, what these are, these categorizations based on these types of companies. And some would be those which we derive out of law, some would be straight out of the law. But yes, I am not talking about the legal language here, because all of us are professionals who've been dealing with those legal understandings, and the verbatim reproduction is not required when I have chartered accountants sitting on the other end who equally understand law as company as do company secretaries, or as do advocates, if I say it so. Then when I deal with the subject of issue of share capital, I have categorized it into 5 schedules, which again do not go as law goes. So I am not again reproducing any verbatim law. I would be telling you, okay, these are the 5 types which could be undertaken when we are doing it practically. Third, when I'm talking about alteration, I'll be talking with you that, okay, what is the mechanism? What is the process that we need to undertake when we're altering the MOA and AOA of the companies? And what are the nitty-gritties? A few questions that definitely arise in any professional's mind, or when I have been dealing with other professionals, what kind of queries came to me? So they were like limited 3 or 4 queries, but of course I've tried to incorporate them in the presentation. And last, when we are talking about alteration of MOA and AOA, let me also state, prior to last year, if I say somewhere around close to 2019, there was this requirement which came that public limited companies need to go for a dematerialization of shares despite those companies being unlisted. Then thereafter, many companies have till date gone to becoming private limited companies from public limited companies. And this is also by mode of alteration of your MOA and AOA, because of course you change your set of articles, you'll change your memorandum, because your company type would change, then your number of members may change, your number of directors come down to a statutory minimum to then three. So of course, there is again an interplay of both alteration of MOA and AOA, which is required in that particular process. So that being a very relevant thing, I would be dealing with that particular process in totality with all of you towards the end of the presentation. So I think that would be the icing on the cake as well. Some brownie points for the members here for this particular session is this particular aspect, which many of you may advise to your clients that you may not go to get your shares dematerialized, especially when it's a closely held company, where it's a family concern. And you may take this particular route of converting your company from a public limited to a private limited. And trust me, I've done it for one of my family concerns as well. So with that, I would quickly get into the mode of the presentation. What I would also request is, since all of us are equally audible on either sides, one quick request. Do you want queries to happen simultaneously, or do you want it to happen at the end of the session? If it has to happen simultaneously, please use the audio mode. Because of course, during the pendency of the presentation, I may not be able to access the chat box to go through all questions. And if you want that the questions should happen towards the end of the session, then please keep flooding the chat box with your respective queries at all times, whenever you feel there is something you need to discuss and talk about. So very quickly, if I get the view of the house in this query mandate of how do you want it to happen at a few moments from now when we begin with this particular second session of the day. So within a minute or so, if we clarify on that, I would thereafter come at the end. Okay, there's somebody, Ms. Anju Bhatt, who's just stated, let's have it at the end. All right, Anjuji, since that's the only view I have got as of now, therefore I would continue with that particular understanding that we have all our queries happening towards the end of this particular session. Okay, Neha Ben Naik. Okay, so I think the members are already charged up for this particular session, and therefore I am now receiving Shanti Lalji. Now I would stop taking names, but I would start with the presentation, which is again the mandate for this particular evening. Now, of course, you've been talking about LLPs with Vikasji here, who's of course somebody who's too much into LLP structuring and how things should flow and what are the benefits. So personally, we've had a lot of interactions on this as well. So of course, after this energetic session that you've had, this creates double the onus on me that nobody should go without takeaways from this particular session as well. So after an enlightening session from Vikasji, if I may say so, of course, having experienced a lot of his sessions as a viewer as well as a participant at the other end at certain occasions, let me now commence this particular session with the permission of the house. Now, our first topic right now is on types of companies. Now, if I talk about types of companies, the first is on the basis of incorporation, where you have statutory companies and if you have registered companies. Now, what are statutory companies? They are constituted by a special act of the parliament or the state legislature. Now, for example, if I say ICAI, ICSI, ICMAI, which is again ICAI cost, they are registered under a special act of the parliament. And that's there on the membership card of we members as well. So constituted by a special act of the parliament, these are statutory companies. Then Reserve Bank of India is another option. Life Insurance Corporation of India, LIC, is another option. registered companies, those which are registered under the Companies Act 2013, जो कि अभी हमारा present prevalent law है, या कोई और previous company law. For example, अगर मैं presidency terms के time की बात करूँ, इससे पहले Companies Act 1956 के time की बात करूँ, so those are all registered companies because we are registered under the company law statute, जो आज की date में है या जो आज से पहले company law से ही deal करता हुआ statute था. Then types of company on the basis of liability. Liable companies limited by shares is the first that you talk about. So my members' liability is limited here, and this is limited to the extent of the shares or the amount which is unpaid by them. So those are for company limited by shares. Now, this liability can be enforced at any point of time. So, jitna amount inka unpaid hai, kabhi bhi hum isko enforce kar sakte hain, inse mangwa sakte hain. Chahe during the existence of the company, we can say, okay, this was my application amount, this was my second allotment amount, this was my third allotment amount, 2 rupees is still payable. I go for an allotment, I call for the balance amount, and my member shall have to pay. Or else during the winding up of the company, when I have to pay off the expenditure, I can also call from these members where their amount is still unpaid. Wo contributory ki list mein bhi aa jate hain hamare. Agar main liquidation ke terms mein baat karu, then agar unke shares fully paid up hai to unki koi liability nahi hai. Kyun? Kyunki unko us 10 rupees ke share ke andar unhone agar 10 ka 10 pay kar rakha hai, they don't need to pay me any other amount. 10 ka 8 hai, they can pay me, they have to pay me 2 rupees amount mandatorily. Now this is the most common types of company which is otherwise prevalent, and these may be either public or private. अब प्राइवेट की जब मैं बात करूंगी, प्लीज ऑल्सो रिमेंबर, प्राइवेट के अंदर एक हमारी नॉर्मल प्राइवेट कंपनी है, एक हमारी वन पर्सन कंपनी है. वन पर्सन कंपनी जिसके अंदर आपका एक मेंबर है, उसका एक नॉमिनी है, और डायरेक्टर्स आप कितने भी रख सकते हो, जितनी आपकी मैक्सिमम स्टैट्यूटरी लिमिट 15 की है उसके हिसाब से. नाउ सेकंड इज कंपनी इज लिमिटेड बाय गारंटी. नाउ हियर द मेंबर्स हु आर सब्सक्राइबिंग टू द मेमोरेंडम ऑफ एसोसिएशन ऑफ द कंपनी लिमिटेड बाय गारंटी, they have to contribute to the assets of the company when the company is being wound up. And uska jitni guarantee unhone le rakhi hai, utne hi amount ki unki liability banegi. So there's no specific share capital of the company. When you even register that particular company, aapko share capital is not mandatory. Ab isme what types of companies go ahead for companies limited by guarantee? The companies which go ahead for being formed as companies limited by guarantee are generally trade associations, research associations, clubs, or societies which have different types of objects. So inke paas ye option hota hai that they think that being a company limited by guarantee is a more viable option for them. Unlimited liability company, so jisne unlimited liability of company bana diya, as the word suggests, the limit of the liability of the members is unlimited. That is, they are liable for the company's debts in totality, but in the respective proportion of the respective interest. Jaise agar for example kisi ka ratio ban raha hai ji 5:4:1, so these three members in this unlimited liability company, say out for a debt of say 10 lakhs, it will be 5 lakhs, 4 lakhs and 1 lakhs, depending on the limit or proportion of their respective interest. Now such companies again may or may not have share capital. Next, types of company on the basis of number of members. अगर मैं इसके बारे में फ्रेंकली बात करूं, नंबर ऑफ मेंबर्स की हम बात करें, हमारे पास सबसे पहले दिमाग में पब्लिक, प्राइवेट और ओपीसी ही आता है. ओपीसी आई एम नॉट स्पेसिफिकली कैटेगराइजिंग इन दिस पर्टिकुलर थिंग, बट आई हैव टेकन इट विद इन अ प्राइवेट कंपनी इटसेल्फ. नाउ पब्लिक कंपनी हैज बीन डिफाइंड अंडर सेक्शन 271 ऑफ द कंपनीज एक्ट. अब ये पब्लिक कंपनी में हमारे मिनिमम क्या होते हैं, मिनिमम 3 डायरेक्टर्स होने चाहिए, मिनिमम 7 शेयर होल्डर्स होने चाहिए, कंपनी के नाम के एंड में लिमिटेड ऐड होना चाहिए, उसके बाद इसके शेयर फ्रीली ट्रांसफरेबल होते हैं, जो कि हमारे प्राइवेट कंपनी में नहीं होता. प्राइवेट कंपनी में करना होगा तो पहले मेरे को जो मेरे इंटरनली बाकी शेयर होल्डर्स है उनको एक ऑफर देना पड़ेगा दैट कम ऑन इंटर से ट्रांसफर कर सकते हैं, दैट यू कैन बाय आउट माय शेयर्स विद इन, एंड द शेयर होल्डिंग रिमेन्स विद इन द इमीडिएट शेयर होल्डर्स. इफ नो वन इज विलिंग टू परचेज दैट शेयर होल्डिंग, देन यू गो अहेड एंड ऑफर द शेयर्स अहेड फर्दर टू एनीबडी एल्स. नाउ दिस इज नॉट द केस हियर, द शेयर्स आर फ्रीली ट्रांसफरेबल, यू नीड नॉट गो टू द इमीडिएट शेयर होल्डर्स ऑफ द कंपनी. You can sell the shares outside the company and outside the existing members of the company as well. अब इसके अंदर एक deemed वाला provision था जो कि Companies Act 1956 में भी था, जो 2013 में further carry forward हुआ, and this was that a private company जो एक public company की subsidiary है, मेरे पास एक पब्लिक कंपनी है, उसकी एक सब्सिडरी है जो एक प्राइवेट कंपनी है, तो उस प्राइवेट कंपनी को भी मैं पब्लिक कंपनी डीम करूंगी, और इसलिए वो डीमिंग प्रोविजन आ जाता है जो कहता है मानो या ना मानो मानना पड़ेगा। तो चाहे उस प्राइवेट कंपनी को मैं पब्लिक मानूं या ना मानूं, बट क्योंकि वो पब्लिक कंपनी की सब्सिडरी है मेरे को उसको पब्लिक कंपनी मानना ही पड़ेगा। अब नेक्स्ट है प्राइवेट कंपनी, अब पब्लिक वॉज अंडर 271 ऑफ द कंपनीज एक्ट, दिस इज अंडर 268 ऑफ द कंपनीज एक्ट। अब इसमें मेजर चीजें क्या है, मेजर चीज सबसे पहले अगर मैं बात करूं यहाँ पे लिमिट ऑफ नंबर ऑफ मेंबर्स, मेरी अगर कंपनीज एक्ट 1956 के हिसाब से बात करूं 50 की थी, नया नया ये लॉ आया था तब भी 50 की थी, उसके बाद इसमें अमेंडमेंट आई इसमें 200 कर दिया। सो मैक्सिमम नंबर ऑफ मेंबर्स दैट आई कैन हैव इन केस ऑफ प्राइवेट कंपनीज 200 मेंबर्स, एक्सेप्ट इन केस ऑफ अ वन पर्सन कंपनी जहां पे मैक्स यू कैन हैव ओनली वन मेंबर फॉलोड बाय वन नॉमिनी हु विल बी मेंबर एट अ लेटर स्टेज। Then restrict the right to transfer its shares, वो भी हमने public company के time में छोटा सा discuss करा कि भी private और public में इसमें differentiation क्या होती है। Now when we're talking about the number of members of this particular company, then दो चीजें हमें ध्यान रखनी है कि भाई this is the first point I'm talking is applicable for a public company as well, कि जब मेरे दो या दो से ज्यादा लोग jointly एक share को hold करते हैं तो वो एक ही member treat होंगे। Say for example, if I have to term it as there may joint holding of shares is permitted, the first holder shall be considered the main holder, the second holder shall receive the benefit once the first holder either transfers the shares in the name of the first joint holder, that is the second holder, or he becomes incapacitated in any manner. Say for example, if he becomes a deceased member, then my joint holder, the second holder, shall automatically get the shares transferred in his name or transmitted in his name, if I may say, because transfer is when living, it's amongst living beings, and transmission is when one of the when your shareholder or member is deceased. So when your first holder is deceased, the second holder shall automatically get the shares transmitted in his name by virtue of being the second shareholder. Ab agar jab agar is tarike ke clause mein difference aata hai, ज्वाइंट होल्डर को वो लोग मेंबर नहीं बना रहे होते हैं, तो हम सेक्शन 58 सेक्शन 59 ऑफ कंपनीज एक्ट में जाके एनसीएलटी से ऑर्डर लेते हैं कि भाई द कंपनी इज नॉट अलाउइंग द सेकंड होल्डर टू बिकम अ मेंबर इन द कंपनी इन केस ऑफ ज्वाइंट होल्डिंग वेयर इट एग्जिस्टेड। देन पर्संस हु आर इन द एम्प्लॉयमेंट ऑफ द कंपनी एंड पर्संस हु हैविंग बीन फॉर्मली इन द एम्प्लॉयमेंट ऑफ द कंपनी, यानी कि जो आज एम्प्लॉयड हैं या पहले कभी इस कंपनी के एम्प्लॉयज थे and have continued to be members after the employment cease, yani ki employee banke employment chhod diye aur tab bhi members bane hue hain, unko hum in 200 ki list mein nahi manenge, they shall be excluded from the list of the members who are 200 in number. ab isme kya kya prohibition aati hai when we are talking about for public company or a private company, to meri private company mein there is a prohibition for invitation to the public to subscribe for securities. Then, इसके अंदर मिनिमम हमारे टू डायरेक्टर्स हैं, प्राइवेट लिमिटेड एंड में आता है, इसको बहुत सारी एग्जेम्पशंस मिलती रहती हैं। June 5, 2015 का जो नोटिफिकेशन आया था वो एक मेजर अमेंडमेंट्स सेट ऑफ अमेंडमेंट्स लाया था फॉर प्राइवेट कंपनीज। सो जब अमेंडमेंट्स देने की बात आती है, जो एग्जेम्पशंस देने की बात आती है, पब्लिक कंपनीज से ज्यादा प्राइवेट को दिया जाता है बिकॉज कहा जाता है वो छोटी कंपनी है तभी वो पब्लिक बन के आ रही है। अब इसमें एक मेजर अमेंडमेंट आज की डेट तक जो लोग क्वेरीज पूछते ही पूछते हैं, काफी क्वेरीज आती है ऑन दिस, डोंट नो व्हाई बट स्टिल, व्हाट इज द मिनिमम अमाउंट ऑफ पेड शेयर कैपिटल दैट यू रिक्वायर फॉर इनकॉर्पोरेटिंग अ पब्लिक कंपनी और अ प्राइवेट कंपनी, एंड गो थ्रू द व्हाट्सएप ग्रुप व्हिच हैज दिस क्वेश्चन एंड देयर वुड स्टिल बी सम पीपल, ट्रस्ट मी दे आर नॉट चार्टर्ड अकाउंटेंट्स अलोन बट दे आर कंपनी सेक्रेटरीज ऑल्सो, दे आर एडवोकेट्स ऑल्सो, there are our interns also throughout all these professions. 1 lakh 5 lakh 1 lakh 5 lakh 1 lakh 5 lakh, and we need to remind that this has been dispensed away with already. So aap chahte ho to aap 5000 se bhi company bana sakte ho, 10000 se bhi bana sakte ho, 15000 se bhi bana sakte ho, but what you need to understand and what you need to tell your clients is that boss, at least an incorporation cost should move out of that particular paid up amount, and that would be a viable option. So with that much, at least as paid up capital, you should incorporate your company. Third is a one-person company. Of course, we've discussed about it. Having one person, one member, one director minimum. You can have more directors as and where required. Now, some people come ahead and say, trust me, they are clients only. मैंने अभी इसको नॉमिनी बना दिया, मैं क्या बाद में नॉमिनी चेंज कर सकता हूँ? ये जवाब आता है और लोगों का, नहीं. Now, here the point is, MCA has given us a facility of changing the nominee at a subsequent time as well. For that, a specific procedure has been outlined under the Companies Act. A specific form has been outlined under the Companies Act. So, if someone is made as a nominee at a present date, the nominee can be changed at a subsequent date if the member so desires. So, aaj kisi ko nominee bana diya, iska matlab ye nahi hai. Till the end of the company or till the time the member is not deceased or is incapacitated, the nominee shall be same. The nominee can be changed. And this nominee has to be designated when the company is being incorporated. Ab iske bahut sare separate privileges or exemptions hote hain when we talk about OPC. Well, meri AGM us din ho gayi jis din pe my accounts are signed by the director and the auditor. Wherever my member is present and my member is also signed through my financials if he is the director, well and good. 180 days tak mein कभी भी ये सब हो सकता है, मैं एजीएम विल डीम टू बी हैव बीन कंसीडर्ड. आफ्टर दैट मुझे कोरम की रिक्वायरमेंट नहीं है बिकॉज मेरा वो एक मेंबर काफी है किसी भी चीज के लिए. देन मेरे डायरेक्टर्स अगर एक है, तो जब मेरा डायरेक्टर प्रेजेंट है, जब मेरा डायरेक्टर प्रेजेंट है सिंगल वाला, मेरी मीटिंग हो गई. आई डोंट हैव टू गो एंड सी कि मेरे सारे डायरेक्टर्स को नोटिस डिलीवर हुआ या नहीं हुआ. मेरे को नोटिस की डिलीवरी चेक करने की जरूरत नहीं है. व्हाई? बिकॉज माय डायरेक्टर विल ओनली इशू द नोटिस ऑन बिहाफ ऑफ द बोर्ड इन एन ओपीसी. ऑफ कोर्स barring the case that, okay, it would have been any other type of company where you would have had a company secretary who's under the instructions of the board issuing the notice of a board meeting, there would have been a separate situation. But in case if it's an OPC where you have only one director, whether or not notice was delivered cannot be the subject of a question being raised subsequently. So that way is pretty much relaxations in terms of OPC vis-a-vis private. So if I say the most number of relaxations are for OPC, thereafter a private limited company, and thereafter a public limited company. Now, many people still come and ask, despite ki bhai 2014 mein we've already had Companies Act 2013 come into picture, full-fledged from 1st April, but still this query comes on OPC ka naam kaise rakhenge? Ji, agar mere ko naam likhna hai OPC, APC, ABC, to ABC bracket mein OPC, bracket closed, private limited, that is how we will designate this particular company. Now, another thing which comes. Many of us have the habit of writing PVT LTD dot. And that is the case in case of limited companies also, public limited companies also, we, at the end of the name, we write LTD dot. And because of that habit, incorporation karte samay aadat ho gayi hai ki bhai wahan pe bhi LTD dot chala jata hai. ROC sabse pehle ye resubmission zarur dalta hai, ji ye dot mat dalo, completely likho. तो PRIVATE space LIMITED या फिर LTD dot की जगह LIMITED has to come in completion. बस सिर्फ OPC लिखने के लिए आप bracket OPC as it is लिख सकते हैं, वहां पे one person company लिखने की जरूरत नहीं है. Now types of company on the basis of domicile. That is मेरी company कहां situated है. अगर इंडिया में formed है, इंडिया में ही registered है, इंडियन कंपनी कहलाएगी. पर इंडिया के अंदर मेरी बिजनेस एक्टिविटी है, प्लेस ऑफ बिजनेस है, चाहे मैं खुद करूं यहाँ पर आकर या किसी एजेंट को यहाँ पर डेजिग्नेट करूं फिजिकली या इलेक्ट्रॉनिकली, पर Amazon basically is a US based company. It has further businesses registered across the globe. So that's a foreign company when I talk about in that particular perception. But yahan agar subsidiary ke through operate kar rahi hai, to wo subsidiary agar India mein registered hai, that subsidiary becomes a Indian company. But if it is operating, say through a branch office, a liaison office, a project office, or as registering as a foreign company, then it becomes a foreign company. Section 8 company. Ab jiske objects hote hain ji, aapka promotion of commerce, promotion of arts, say research से related, social welfare से related. अब अगर हम ICI के RVO की बात करें, ठीक है, that is a Section 8 company. Then अगर हम लोग IIIP of ICAI की बात करें, जो insolvency professionals की है, that is also a Section 8 company. Then there is another one. I think I was in touch with Charterpreneurs Foundation. So उनकी बात करूं, उनका हम लोग कुछ काम कर रहे थे. They are also a Section 8 company. So इन सब companies का काम क्या होता है कि हम promotion of commerce, promotion of arts, promotion of then there was some which was dealing with protection of art, environment. अगर मैं PETA की बात करूं, so it is for any action against animals, उनको protect करने के लिए अगर है, that is also registered as a Section 8 company. Now these companies have to apply the profits in promoting the objects of the company, and they cannot make any dividend payment to the members of the company. Now, अब इन companies के नाम के पीछे हमें limited या private limited लगाने की जरूरत नहीं है. Now, for example, foundation word लगा लिया. These kinds of specific अलग अलग words होते हैं जो हम इनके नाम के पीछे लगाएंगे. हमें limited, private limited, OPC private limited लगाने की जरूरत नहीं है. अब इनके लिए एक चीज जरूर ध्यान रखनी है कि भाई पहले का सिस्टम होता था, आज से कुछ 6 महीना साल पहले, before we had these forms, consolidated forms for registration and license, कि हम incorporation के time, we're first going, getting the name approved. Name approval आता है CRC से, उसके बाद हम जा रहे थे INC 12 के अंदर license लेने कि Section 8 company के लिए अलाउ कर दो. उसके बाद क्या हुआ, जनरली वो लाइसेंस आते जाते इतना टाइम हो जाता था कि हमारी कंपनी का नाम जो है उसको जो नाम अप्रूव था उसका टाइम लिमिट खत्म हो जाता था. तो हम कंपनी इनकॉर्पोरेशन जो आगे स्टेज पे होता था वो कर नहीं पाते थे. अब व्हाट दे हैव डन इज कि एक कॉमन फॉर्म बना दिया कि इसी फॉर्म के अंडर आप सेक्शन 8 कंपनी के लिए नाम भी रिजर्व करो, आप उसका लाइसेंस जो पहले INC 12 में लेते थे वो भी इसी में लो, और उसके बाद इनकॉर्पोरेशन के डॉक्यूमेंट्स भी इसी कंपनी के यहीं पे डाल दो. So it has now become a consolidated form. Otherwise, earlier the process was more tedious in terms of time frame. They did not issue the licenses within that specific time period, as was with respect to the name. Now there is another thing which has happened. They say ab aapko agar 30 din ke liye naam rakhna hai itni fees do, 60 din ke liye naam rakhna hai itna fees do, 20 din ke liye naam rakhna hai itna fees do. So they have extended the tenure basis the, or they have increased the amount of fees basis the amount of time you would want to reserve a name for a company. So that way is, I think they have understood that there are certain problems in this particular process which hinder registration of company within the time frame required. So I think this privilege has come for all companies as a bunch, if I say. Next type of company is a government company, jisme 51% paid up share capital kam se kam meri central government ki hai, state government ki hai, ya central or state saath mein, ya पार्टली बाय मेनी स्टेट गवर्नमेंट्स हो सकती है. अब अगर कोई गवर्नमेंट कंपनी की सब्सिडरी आती है तो उसको भी हम गवर्नमेंट कंपनी ही ट्रीट करेंगे एंड सेक्शन 2 क्लॉज 45. देन कम्स स्मॉल कंपनी. नाउ स्मॉल कंपनी टू क्राइटेरियाज. वन क्राइटेरिया, माय पेड अप शेयर कैपिटल डज नॉट एक्सीड 50 लाख एंड माई टर्न ओवर डज नॉट एक्सीड 2 करोड़ रुपीज. अगर ये दोनों कंडीशन मेरे सेटिस्फाई हो रहे हैं, माई कंपनी शैल बी अ स्मॉल कंपनी. But this company should not be a public company. This will be applicable in case of a private company only. Now, where will this not be applicable on? This will not be applicable in case of a holding company, a subsidiary company, a Section 8 company, then a statutory company. A statutory company kaun si? Jo kisi special act ke under registered ho. Subsidiary company. Ab ye definition Companies Act mein aayi, usse pehle ye definition accounting standards mein aayi thi. अब सब्सिडरी कंपनी को मैं क्या बोलूंगी, सब्सिडरी कंपनी वो कंपनी होगी जिसका बोर्ड ऑफ डायरेक्टर्स का कंपोजिशन इज कंट्रोल्ड बाय माय कंपनी विच इज द होल्डिंग कंपनी, और आई कैन एक्सरसाइज मोर देन 1/2 ऑफ द टोटल वोटिंग पावर आइदर थ्रू माय कंपनी विच इज द होल्डिंग कंपनी और थ्रू माय सेल्फ एंड अदर सब्सिडरी कंपनीज. सो दैट वे इज अ सब्सिडरी कंपनी इज अनदर टाइप ऑफ कंपनी विच हैज बीन डिफाइंड अंडर द कंपनीज एक्ट. अब इसके अंदर एक लेयर का सिस्टम आया था एंड दैट लेयर सिस्टम सेड दैट मोर देन 2 लेयर्स इज नॉट परमिसिबल. मतलब होल्डिंग, सब्सिडरी, सब्सिडरी, एक लेयर, 2 लेयर तक मैं सब्सिडरी कंपनीज खोल सकती हूं. नेक्स्ट एसोसिएट कंपनी. अब ये एसोसिएट कंपनी ऑफ कोर्स अगेन AS 23 में ये कॉन्सेप्ट पहले आया, कंपनीज एक्ट में ये 2 क्लॉज 6 में 1 अप्रैल 2014 से एप्लीकेबल हुआ. उससे पहले हमने कभी भी इसकी डेफिनेशन कंपनीज एक्ट के परस्पेक्टिव से नहीं देखी. because it never existed. Now, this is one company, of course, which is not a subsidiary company of the company, but it includes a joint venture. अब इसके अंदर क्या क्या चीजें हमें ध्यान रखनी है? Significant influence होना चाहिए. वो significant influence means at least 20% of the total voting power control or participation in business decisions होना चाहिए. Very similar to AS23. Second, expression joint venture. यहाँ पर joint arrangement की भाई joint control of rights to the net assets होना चाहिए. Again very similar to the AS23, which you chartered accountants would understand better than me. Trust me on that. प्रोड्यूसर कंपनी. अब जो जनरली आपके रेकग्नाइज्ड बॉडी ऑफ फार्मर्स हैं या एग्रीकल्चरिस्ट्स हैं, उनको सपोर्ट देने के लिए, उनका गुड स्टेटस इनेबल करने के लिए, उनकी प्रॉफिटेबिलिटी बढ़ाने के लिए गवर्नमेंट ने प्रोड्यूसर कंपनी का सिस्टम इंट्रोड्यूस किया. अब March 17, 2020 को कंपनीज अमेंडमेंट बिल जो 2020 का आया, उसके अंदर देर वॉज न्यू चैप्टर विच वॉज एडेड in the act with similar provisions on producer companies. Dormant company, ये मेरा section 455 of Companies Act में आता है. अभी वो companies है जो generally कोई business transaction नहीं कर रही, but ये asset hold करने के लिए खड़ी हैं, या फिर कोई IPR है जो इनके नाम में है, जिस IPR के basis पे they're operating, कोई significant accounting transaction नहीं है, कोई कोई specific revenue नहीं है इस company के पास, तो उस कंपनी को जनरली हम लोग कहते हैं कि एक रेगुलर कंपनी बना के रखने की जगह आप इनको एक डोमिनेंट कंपनी का स्टेटस दे दो अंडर सेक्शन 455, फॉर व्हिच अ स्पेसिफिक एप्लीकेशन हैज टू बी मूव्ड टू द आरओसी. नाउ इस वर्ड को हमने स्पेसिफिकली 2017 के अंदर भी बहुत सुना. व्हाई? बिकॉज़ आरओसी ने सबसे पहले नोटिस भेजे जी स्ट्राइक ऑफ कंपनी के, तो उन्होंने सबसे पहले ये लिखा कि आइदर यू कंप्लीट योर फाइलिंग्स या फाइलिंग्स आर ड्यू, वी आर इन द प्रोसेस ऑफ स्ट्राइकिंग ऑफ योर कंपनी, और यू मे मेक एन एप्लीकेशन for registering your company as a dormant company. That was the first time probably we started hearing as professionals ki bhi dormant company ke liye bhi ministry ya ROC offices activate ho gaye hain. So of course that was one significant occasion. Aur uske baad 2017 ki list aayi, 18 ki list aayi, 19 mein bhi list aayi, 20 ke andar bhi list aayi, jahan par companies have been struck off and many companies did opt ki bhi hame dormant ka status hi de do. And there is a specific procedure which has to be followed. अब, as I close down on this, and now I move on to issue of share capital. अब now I said कि मैं इसमें पांच तरीके के issuance के process के बारे में बात करूंगी. Now what are these five methods of issuance of shares? One is private placement. Second is preferential allotment. यानी कि I have to give it to a specific person again. Right issue, conversion of loan or debentures into shares, जो कि generally हम लोग बात करते हैं कि मेरे को suddenly net worth of the company बढ़ानी है, मेरे को पैसा डालना नहीं है, मेरे पास already loan खड़ा है, ये मेरा डायरेक्टर है या मेरा मेंबर है, अब कैसे करा जाए? Then we go on for this particular process also. And last, bonus issue. So within these five particular methodologies, we would be dealing on each one of them in brief before I take your move on to the next segment and thereafter the queries. First, if I go on for private placement, by irrespective of whatever the section is, the word itself says private, मेरे को person कोई होगा उसको ये placement करी जाएगी, यानी कि there is a select group of person जो कि identified हो, so this person should be identifiable, you should have identified the person before you go on for issuance. मतलब ये नहीं कर सकते कि आप अपने members को जाके बोलो कि भाई members I need more money and you may go on for these issuance of these shares and you may subscribe to these shares. Now that could be a right issue as well. Right issue at any specific price. Here what they say is you should have a person, a designated person. May I know, say for example, I know two people and I know both of these two people would be willing to invest in my company. So my board of directors have to decide and my board of directors shall thereafter obtain the consent of this person, send him an offer letter, receive the amount. The offer should not less than be ₹20,000 per share or per subscriber value of face value of shares. And this offer letter should be specifically addressed to this particular person who is willing to invest in my company. Ab jaise for example ye ho sakta hai ki meri company ne sabse pehle right issue kiya section 62 mein. Right issue ke baad kya hua? Ji, right issue fails. None of my members are willing to subscribe to the shares of the company anymore. जो उनको लग रहा है कि भाई पैसा ऑलरेडी लगा दिया है एंड वी आर नॉट गेटिंग द डिजायर्ड रिटर्न. नाउ आफ्टर दिस वन फेल्स दे डू नॉट इवन रिनाउंस देयर शेयर्स इन फेवर ऑफ समबडी एल्स. What happens next is my company's board can decide that okay, we have an identified investor who's willing to invest in the company. They say, since my right issue has failed, I can go on for private placement. This person who's willing, I can move on and proceed with the private placement mechanism and the process with this particular identified investor. Usko offer bheja jayega 30 days ke andar. He has to then go ahead with the particular process. Roz bande ka naam mera company ke register of members mein record kar liya jayega. Now, अब इसके अंदर अगर मैं एक स्पेसिफिक चीज की बात करूं तो इसके अंदर ये है कि जी आपका ऑफर लेटर का फॉर्मेट ऑलरेडी इज देयर. यू हैव टू फॉलो स्ट्रिक्टली PAS-4. नाउ दिस PAS-4 हैज टू फर्दर बी अटैच्ड टू अ स्पेसिफिक ई फॉर्म आल्सो व्हेन यू आर फाइलिंग विद द ROC. सो अगेन उसके अंदर भी आपको वो फॉर्मेट को स्ट्रिक्टली फॉलो करना पड़ेगा. एंड यू हैव टू शो. इसमें एक चीज और होती है कि जी डिस्पैच ऑफ फॉर्म कब हुआ है, डिस्पैच ऑफ लेटर, देन आपके पास रिसीट कब आई है उसकी. सो बेटर इज शो हैंड रिसीट इफ दैट इज पॉसिबल कि बाय हैंड डिलीवर हुआ, बाय हैंड उन्होंने एक्नॉलेज कर दिया एंड आई हैव प्रिजर्व्ड अ कॉपी फॉर पर्पस ऑफ माय रिकॉर्ड्स. व्हाई हम लोग कर देते हैं बाद में क्लाइंट कहता है जी रिकॉर्ड तो बनाए नहीं थे या रिकॉर्ड तो है नहीं. So somewhere or the other, responsibility gets cast on the professional at that point of time. So it is better in case if your client is saying that this is the identified investor, ask your client to say to go get the acknowledgement from that identified investor, say it is received by hand. Then there should be a specified separate bank account, just a subscription hogi aur jisme subscription ka paisa jayega pehle, just like an IPO. Then if you are doing a private placement offer, uske liye pehle aap members ke paas jao, EGM karo, ya fir agar EGM ka due date aas paas hai, EGM ke andar ek special resolution pass karo by the shareholders of the company, by the members of the company, and thereafter proceed with the private placement mechanism. Then price of the private placement should be determined ki bhai kis price pe mereko ye private placement karni hai, isme kitna mera element rahega securities premium ka. And now while this is happening, please remember our registered valuer and the company is at. Is the person who's authorized to do this valuation of the price of the private placement. Excuse me. Then we have an explanatory statement. For example, if I'm calling for an EGM, I have passed a special resolution. Mere ko ek explanatory statement dalna padta hai in case of a special resolution. Ab is explanatory statement mein mere ko dena padega ki bhai mera jo ye price hai jo ki arrive at hua hai by my valuer, ये क्यों जस्टिफाइड है. अगर कोई प्रीमियम है तो ये प्रीमियम क्यों जस्टिफाइड है व्हाइल आई एम गोइंग फॉर इश्यूज ऑफ शेयर्स. और जब तक कि मेरा ये अलॉटमेंट कंप्लीट नहीं हो जाता तब तक मैं दूसरा कोई अलॉटमेंट इनिशिएट नहीं कर सकती. मैं जब तक ये प्राइवेट प्लेसमेंट पूरा कंप्लीट नहीं हो जाता आफ्टर रिसीट ऑफ मनी तब तक आई कैनॉट गो फॉर अ फर्दर प्राइवेट प्लेसमेंट, आई कैनॉट गो फॉर अ फर्दर राइट इशू, आई कैनॉट गो फॉर अ फर्दर बोनस इशू फॉर एनी सॉर्ट ऑफ इश्यूज ऑफ शेयर कैपिटल. नाउ एक चीज और जो बहुत लोग करते हैं, बहुत कंपनीज ये गलती करती हैं, आपने प्राइवेट प्लेसमेंट खत्म कर लिया, PAS-3 पेंडिंग था, कंपनी में पैसा यूटिलाइज कर लिया. प्लीज रिमेंबर दैट वंस द मनी इज रिसीव्ड प्लीज गो अहेड एंड फाइल द PAS-3 फॉर्म फर्स्ट और उसके बाद ही यूटिलाइजेशन ऑफ मनी होना चाहिए. So utilization cannot be undertaken till the time the specified form PAS-3 is not filed with the registrar of companies for their approval purposes. Now, money is received. If within 60 days I do not issue securities or shares or whatsoever, has to be issued, then in that case, I will have to repay the application money to the subscribers within 15 days. तो मतलब पहले 60 दिन में अगर मैंने शेयर कैपिटल के लिए मतलब पैसे के लिए शेयर कैपिटल इशू नहीं किया, सिक्योरिटीज इशू नहीं करी, तो 60 डेज खत्म होते ही अगले 15 दिन में along with interest at the rate of 12% per annum from the expiry of the 60th day. Now this record of private placement shall be maintained from PAS-5 and PAS-4 जो है वो भी मेरे को ROC में फाइल करना है. किस में फाइल करना है? फॉर्म PAS-3 के अंदर फाइल करना है. आज की डेट में इसका 30 डेज का टाइम पीरियड है, 15 दिन के अंदर अंदर हमें इसको फाइल करना होता था. अब जी इसमें एक चीज और है, अगर ये प्राइवेट प्लेसमेंट के प्रोसेस में कहीं भी इफ यू ब्रीच लॉ, देन देयर इज अ पेनल्टी ऑफ अमाउंट इन्वॉल्वड इन द ऑफर और इनविटेशन ऑफ 2 crore rupees व्हिचएवर इज हायर. वाओ, सो इट इज समथिंग दैट ओके फॉलो द लॉ or else be ready, 2 crores is way too high for any company, say. Next, issue of shares on preferential basis. This is the second method jiske through aap issue of share capital kar sakte ho. Ab ji, agar main preferential basis ki baat karti hu, preferential basis, again, I have an identified investor. I have a group of persons who will be investing in my particular company, but it does not include 1, राइट इशू, 2, पब्लिक इशू, 3, ESOP, 4, बोनस इशू. मतलब मैं उनके पास ही जा रही हूँ, उनसे ही पैसा ले रही हूँ. बस मेरा 20,000 वाली लिमिट नहीं है जो कि मेरे प्राइवेट प्लेसमेंट अंडर सेक्शन 42 में आती है. सेक्शन 62 में ये जब बात कर रहे हैं तो इनके पास 20,000 वाली लिमिट नहीं है, बट आपके पास सिलेक्ट पर्सन होना चाहिए, सिलेक्टेड आइडेंटिफाइड पर्सन या ग्रुप ऑफ पर्सन होना चाहिए जिनको प्रेफरेंस दे रहे हो आप ओवर द एग्जिस्टिंग मेंबर्स ऑफ द कंपनी टू कम एंड इन्वेस्ट इन द पर्टिकुलर कंपनी. नाउ वन मेजर मिस्टेक दैट वी ऑल डू, वन मे आई से मेनी ऑफ अस डू, लेट मी से लाइक दैट, आई विल करेक्ट माय सेल्फ टू दैट एक्सटेंट. अगर हम कोई प्रेफरेंशियल बेसिस का इशू कर रहे हैं तो हमें यह ध्यान रखना पड़ेगा, पहली बात हमारा आर्टिकल्स ऑफ एसोसिएशन में वो अलाउड हो. Many a times, people undertake this kind of a transaction and they realize it was not forming a part of my articles of association. अब इसी के अंदर एक और इशू बताती हूँ. एक एग्जाम्पल था, किसी ने डिफरेंशियल वोटिंग राइट्स के साथ शेयर कैपिटल इशू कर दी एंड किसको करी, प्रेफरेंशियल बेसिस पे एक आइडेंटिफाइड इन्वेस्टर को कर दी. नाउ प्रेफरेंशियल बेसिस तो अलाउड था एज पर आर्टिकल्स ऑफ एसोसिएशन, but preferential basis with differential voting rights was not allowed as per the articles of association. So therefore, if there is any other second caveat also, it is always advisable that we are undertaking any such transaction for our client, please go through the memorandum and articles of association of that particular client at that moment, the updated version if there have been any amendments, see if it is authorized by the articles of association. If yes, only then go ahead. Otherwise, first, go ahead to alter the articles of association of the company. Now, we'll be talking about that process also very shortly. But then, this is one major thing which many of us, I'm correct, I did correct myself this time for the first go itself, that many of us do not see. Now, this issue, which is a preferential issue, it is a fully paid issue at the time of allotment itself. Now, you can say that here, I will make an application first. फिर कॉल मनी करूंगा, फिर एक और कॉल कर सकता हूँ, फिर एक और कॉल कर सकता हूँ. नो, इफ इट्स अ प्रेफरेंशियल इशू, ऑल द मनी नीड्स टू कम टू द कंपनी एट द फर्स्ट शॉट इटसेल्फ. एंड माय एक्सप्लेनेटरी स्टेटमेंट ऑफ माय एजीएम, बिकॉज प्रेफरेंशियल के लिए भी मेरे को मेंबर्स के पास जाके एक रेजोल्यूशन पास कराना पड़ेगा, तो मेरा एक एक्सप्लेनेटरी स्टेटमेंट जाएगा फॉर माई स्पेशल बिजनेस एंड उसके अंदर नेसेसरी फैक्ट्स आने चाहिए मेरे प्रेफरेंशियल इशू के लिए. ये जो प्रेफरेंशियल अलॉटमेंट है मेरे 12 महीने के अंदर फ्रॉम द डेट ऑफ स्पेशल रेजोल्यूशन होना चाहिए, और इसके प्राइस को डिटरमिन करने के लिए भी रजिस्टर्ड वैल्यूअर हैज टू बी गिवन अ स्पेसिफिक असाइनमेंट. थर्ड इज राइट इशू ऑफ शेयर, सेक्शन 62. राइट इशू की बात करो, मैं एग्जिस्टिंग मेंबर्स के पास जा रही हूँ, मेरी कंपनी को शेयर कैपिटल इशू करना है, बट मेरी कंपनी को जनरली एग्जिस्टिंग शेयर होल्डर्स के पास ही जाना है, या जो एम्प्लॉयज, अगर मेरे पास एम्प्लॉय स्टॉक ऑप्शन स्कीम जो कि ईसॉप या ईसॉस होता है उसके पास जाके ही ये पैसा लेना है. सो व्हेन माय एग्जिस्टिंग शेयरहोल्डर्स आर इन्वॉल्वड इन अ केस वेयर द कंपनी प्रपोजेस टू इंक्रीज इट्स सब्सक्राइब्ड कैपिटल, देन राइट इशू ऑफ शेयर्स इज द मोस्ट अडॉप्टेड मैकेनिज्म. नाउ इफ देयर इज एन एग्जिस्टिंग शेयरहोल्डर इशू, देन यू नीड एन ऑर्डिनरी रेजोल्यूशन, बट फर्स्ट अगेन गो चेक योर आर्टिकल्स ऑफ एसोसिएशन इफ राइट्स इशू इज परमिटेड. सेकंड, if it is going under a scheme of employee stock option, then a special resolution has to be passed. The existing shareholders ke case mein we go for an ordinary resolution. In case of employees, we talk about a special resolution. Then whatever, may it be a cash transaction, may it be a non-cash transaction, मेरा एक रजिस्टर्ड वैल्यूअर का वैल्यूएशन रिपोर्ट होना चाहिए जो कि मेरे उस प्राइस को जस्टिफाई करे जो कि मैं राइट इशू में प्रपोज कर रही हूँ टू माई एग्जिस्टिंग शेयर होल्डर्स और टू माई एम्प्लॉइज. लेटर ऑफ ऑफर फॉर राइट इशू ऑफ शेयर्स नीड्स टू बी मेड. ये हमारे शेयर मेंबर्स को जानना चाहिए. मेरे मेंबर्स ने अगर राइट रिनाउंस कर दिया है तो भी मेरे पास कम्युनिकेशन होनी चाहिए या एक स्पेसिफिक टाइम लिमिट होना चाहिए कि भाई विद इन दीज 15 to 30 days, you have to either accept the issue of shares from the date of offer letter or else we will deem that you have rejected the offer letter. Or else what they can also do, they can renounce this particular right, give it to somebody else, and that somebody else can come and invest in my company and become a member of the company. Next, conversion of loans or debentures into shares. Now, I am, for example, director of a company. I have given a certain loan to the company, say around rupees 10 lakhs. The company is unable to pay me my salary also. अब क्या हो सकता है? कंपनी कहेगी सैलरी तो हम दे नहीं सकते, पैसे हैं नहीं. लोन जो आपने दिया था वो भी वापस कर नहीं सकते, पैसे हैं नहीं. तो आप मेरी जो सैलरी पेबल है उसको भी मैं एज अ लोन कंसिडर करके कंपनी पे, बिकॉज दैट इज ड्यू एंड पेबल टू मी, I can get into an agreement with the company and get that converted into share capital of the company. But for this, I need to have passed a special resolution in the extraordinary general meeting of the company or the annual general meeting if it is soon approaching. Ab, if I'm talking about debentures conversion into shares, then whenever my debentures were last issued, to uske terms and conditions mein conversion to shares ka kya policy tha? उसके अंदर मैंने क्या टीएनसी डाले थे कि भाई ये शेयर्स में कब कन्वर्ट होंगे, कितना परसेंट इंटरेस्ट देना पड़ेगा, इंटरेस्ट को कैसे कन्वर्ट करेंगे. तो ऑल दैट मैकेनिज्म व्हिच इज देयर एज पार्ट ऑफ द डिबेंचर इश्यूएंस प्रोसेस नीड टू बी लुक्ड आफ्टर व्हाइल यू आर कन्वर्टिंग योर डिबेंचर्स इनटू शेयर्स इन द कंपनी. अब इसके लिए एक एग्जाम्पल देती हूँ लोन्स वाले के लिए स्पेसिफिकली. So there was this company where they had the director who had given certain loan, extended certain facility to its own company. Now there were three directors initially, and out of these three directors, this company is into education industry, and they provide tablets to the government offices, and the government then passes on to the government schools under some scheme that the students can, from their that particular tablet, they can access certain material and they can upgrade themselves and update themselves in certain aspects. Now this particular company in the year 2015, probably, if I can recollect, they said one of my directors is no more on good terms with me. He is not willing to invest in the company also. He's not willing to come to the company office and work as well. So he just wants to eat up my money. All right. Then he says, okay, I need to push. I have been rendering my services to the company as a director. I have given a loan to the company as well. I have not taken salary from the company as well. So all of them becomes due and payable. Now, till then, 2015, we did not have this due and payable concept under the IBC. So obviously, we could not tell him that person 1 crore, 1 lakh ke upar ka amount hai, you can go and say, aaj ki date mein though it stands to be 1 crore. He may have pushed it if he was not the creditor in control of the company. He was already deemed to be a creditor because obviously he has some due and payable, and he was also in charge of the company. The other director was not even coming. What he said was, I want to secure my money. Now when he said he wanted to secure his money, we said, okay, you have given this loan to the company. Do you have an agreement? Because we'll have to attach some document to the MCA while we are talking about paid up share capital being issued to the company for a non-cash transaction or a cash transaction, because the money is already flown to the company already in the past in terms of your loan or in terms of rendering of your services, so that becomes non-cash. And he says, there's no agreement into picture. We haven't signed a particular agreement with the company. Then what did you do? The suggestion that then came was that hold a board meeting, send that particular document for an extraordinary general meeting, approve a notice, send it to that particular director who's a member as well, Let's see if he comes back with any disagreement or dissent on that particular resolution. Now, that dissent did not come. Will not come because he was not interested in the activities of the company. He was saying the company is making losses. I am not interested in what happens to this company later on. So don't ask me for any money. He did not give a dissent. We gave him a time frame. He did not come to the general meeting of the company as well. Extraordinary general meeting was called. After that, the company then noted that this share capital loan of the company is being transferred into share capital. Now, the authorized share capital was huge enough. So at that point of time, we did not have to really go into the process of increasing the authorized share capital of the company and thereafter undertake this. So authorized share capital was well within the reach. And therefore, this particular loan of the company was converted to share capital. This particular salary payable of the promoter director, who's also a member of the company, was converted into the share capital of the company. So both of these together, I remember 2015, we had got it converted into share capital of the company. And trust me, this man thereafter went before the NCLT. And before the NCLT, then he stated that they have undertaken an act which is not in persons of law. The NCLT went through our documentation. And thereafter it said, the process has been followed. You did not yet exercise your right as a director when you were called for the board meeting. You did not exercise your right when you were called as a member to cast your vote at the general meeting of the company. And therefore, today, when they have undertaken a transaction which is valid in terms of law and the entire due process has been followed, then do not state that this transaction which has been undertaken by the company is not valid at all. So this is one particular mechanism which you can undertake. And it's not just when I say loans or debentures, but also salary payables for our promoter directors as well, which could be undertaken as a particular mechanism for conversion into shares. Fifth, bonus issue. Now, when I talk about bonus issue, all of us definitely, you guys know it better than me, that how do we go about with this calculation? But if I have to talk about the conditions under Companies Act, then one, again, first I should go to my articles and see whether or not I'm authorized under the articles of association of the company. Ki bhai meri company bonus issue kar sakti hai, nahi kar sakti hai. Nahi kar sakti, mere ko pehle articles amend karne padenge. Aur kar sakti hai, toh main process ke saath aage follow karungi. Main general meeting mein us resolution ko put up karungi for bonus issue of the company. My company should not have defaulted in repayment of statutory dues, fixed deposits, debt securities. Agar phir bhi kar diya, 3CD mein aap bhi report kar doge. टैक्स ऑडिट में और उधर कारों के अंदर भी रिपोर्टिंग चली जाएगी. द कंपनी हैज डिफॉल्टेड, वहां से आपको पिकअप हो जाएगा. द कंपनी हैज डिफॉल्टेड इन रीपेमेंट ऑफ द स्टैट्यूटरी ड्यूज. सो फ्रॉम देयर यू कैन रियलाइज दैट दिस कंपनी इज नॉट ऑथराइज्ड टू अंडरटेक अ बोनस इशू. बिफोर आई अंडरटेक अ बोनस इशू, आई शुड ऑल्सो सी दैट माई कंपनीज ऑल शेयर्स आर फुल्ली पेड अप. यानी कि कहीं पर भी मेरा कोई कॉल मनी बचना नहीं चाहिए कि भाई 2 रुपए मंगवाना पेंडिंग है आउट ऑफ 10 या 4 रुपए मंगवाना पेंडिंग है आउट ऑफ 10 रुपीज. I should first have a completely fully paid up shares. Only after that I can go up for bonus issues. Then from where can I do this bonus issue? I can do it from free reserves. I can do it from securities premium account, and I can do it from capital redemption reserves. So these three are outright specifics जहाँ से हम bonus issue कर सकते हैं और उसके लिए पैसे utilize कर सकते हैं. Because मेरे घर में और पैसा नहीं आना, जो मेरी balance sheet में दिख रहा है उसी पैसे को utilize करके मैंने अपने existing shareholders को और पैसा और shares issue करने हैं. अब एक बार बोनस इशू अगर मैंने अनाउंस कर दिया उसको वापस विड्रॉ नहीं कर सकते, तो सोच समझ के ही अनाउंस करना है. बट देयर वंस हैपेंड अ केस वेयर अ कंपनी अनाउंस्ड अ बोनस इशू एंड इट हैड टू विड्रॉ. एंड व्हाई डिड इट विड्रॉ? बिकॉज बाय द टाइम द कंपनी केम द अनाउंसमेंट वॉज मेड एंड द कंपनी वॉज टू इशू द शेयर्स, द कंपनी वेंट इनटू रनिंग लॉसेस. सो दे वेंट टू द हाई कोर्ट, दे ऑब्टेंड एन ऑर्डर टू दैट इफेक्ट. They made an application before the CLB also. This was during the CLB times. And finally, the bonus issue was called back. It was withdrawn by the company. So there are only some specific cases. General, if we look at law, dekhe, general law ke andar wo yehi kahenge ki ji ek baar aapne announce kar diya to aap withdraw nahi kar sakte. But if there is a situation like this, the law gives you an option of moving before the appropriate authority for obtaining an appropriate order. Now I come to the third segment, alteration of MOA and AOA. Ab iske andar hamare do segments hain. First segment talks about the process and a few questions which have come to me in the earlier past. And second, conversion of public company to a private company. And subsequent to that, we will have our queries from our learned members here. Now, why am I only specifically talking about process for the change of alteration of MOA under the Companies Act? Processes why? Because generally, पता है क्या होता है? हमारा law change होता रहता है, तो हमें ये ध्यान नहीं रहता कि भी one by one मेरा series of step क्या है? हम लोग law पढ़ते रहते हैं, but हम तो series of step identify करेंगे, तो हमारा law वहीं पे हमें दिख जाएगा. और काफी बार ये होता है कि हम secretarial standards follow करना भूल जाते हैं. लिखा होता है secretarial standard में जी ये काम करना है, हमने वो काम ही नहीं करा. तो anyway, secretarial standards also come from section 118 of section 10 of the Companies Act 2013. Therefore, since they're coming out of section 118, subsection 10 of the Companies Act, so they come out of my law. Though it is made by an institute, but it comes out of law because of the virtue of 118.10. So that is mandatorily applicable to my company. Until and unless there are specific relaxations given to my type of company within that particular secretarial standard. So it holds its own relevance. Now this section is applicable to all companies, that is section 13. Why? Because all companies will have a memorandum of association depending on humne kaun si table adopt kar rakhi hai. Ab sabse pehle agar mere paas koi bhi alteration ya change of MOA ka option hai, proposal hai, mere ko sabse pehle ye dhyan dena hai ki bhai mere ko apne members ki consideration ke liye resolution pass karana hai, special resolution pass karana hai for alteration of memorandum of association. Agar aisa kuch hai, main without calling a board meeting I cannot issue notice of a general meeting. So the first thing that I do is I hold a board meeting, jiske andar I first approve the fact that my company wants to undertake this particular kind of an act. Second, I go ahead and recommend the proposal to my members of the company in that particular resolution. Third, I approve the notice of that particular extraordinary general meeting or my normal annual general meeting as the case may be. Now, then this notice of the extraordinary general meeting, jisme special resolution hamara pass hona hai, iske andar mein place, date, time of the meeting plus statement on the business to be transacted in the EGM, ye details aayegi, explanatory statement jisko hum kehte hain. Ab iske andar mein COVID times ki ek baat batati hu. Virtual meetings ho rahi hain, virtual meetings abhi hamare liye December 12 se hata ke unhone 31st March tak ka kar diya ki you can have your meetings virtually, electronically, just like we are having it now. इसके अंदर अगर मेरे को करेक्टली याद आ रहा है तो इंफोसिस की मीटिंग हुई थी. इंफोसिस की एजीएम के अंदर दे डिड नॉट स्टेट द वेन्यू ऑफ द मीटिंग, दो एज पर माई सेक्रेटरियल स्टैंडर्ड द नोटिस शैल स्पेसिफाई द प्लेस ऑफ द मीटिंग. नाउ इफ एवरीबॉडी इज अटेंडिंग वर्चुअली दिस प्रैक्टिकली नो प्लेस ऑफ द मीटिंग, सो देयर यू हैव टू गिव द डिटेल्स ऑफ हाउ यू अटेंड दिस मीटिंग, जस्ट लाइक यू हैव बीन सेंट अक्रॉस अ लिंक, you've been sent across the process to register, you've been sent across ki bhai queries puchne hai to kaise puchne hai ya aur kisi specific form pe queries puchne hai ya email pe aap queries bhej sakte ho. The similar criteria that has to be shared with your members of the company when it is a virtual or electronic general meeting. Now it's a special business when you are altering memorandum of association of the company MOA, therefore explanatory statement under section 102 has to go along with the notice of the meeting jiske andar mera SR पास होना है. अब जहां जहां मेरे को एमओए को अल्टर करना है, कैपिटल क्लॉज छोड़ के, कैपिटल क्लॉज के लिए मेरे को ऑर्डिनरी रेजोल्यूशन चाहिए, बाकी सब के लिए मेरे को स्पेशल रेजोल्यूशन चाहिए. अभी ऑथराइज्ड ऑर्डिनरी रेजोल्यूशन फॉर शेयर कैपिटल कहां से आता है? सेक्शन 61 ऑफ द कंपनीज एक्ट से आता है. वो साफ साफ लिखते हैं जी ऑर्डिनरी रेजोल्यूशन ही चाहिए, हमें स्पेशल रेजोल्यूशन की रिक्वायरमेंट नहीं है. अब जब मेरा ये रेजोल्यूशन पास हो जाएगा, SR पास हो जाएगा, तो मैं MGT 14 के अंदर इसको फाइल करूंगी विद इन 30 डेज ऑफ हैविंग पास्ड दैट पर्टिकुलर रेजोल्यूशन इन द जनरल मीटिंग ऑफ द कंपनी. देन इस स्पेशल रेजोल्यूशन की कॉपी, मेरे नोटिस की कॉपी, मेरे एक्सप्लेनेटरी स्टेटमेंट की कॉपी, मेरे ऑल्टर्ड मेमोरेंडम एंड आर्टिकल्स की कॉपी जाएगी मेरे MGT 14 में. सेंट्रल गवर्नमेंट के साथ फाइल होगा कि मेरा चेंज ऑफ नेम और चेंज ऑफ रजिस्टर्ड ऑफिस के क्लॉज के अंदर ये चेंज आएगा, तो वो भी हम स्पेसिफिक फॉर्म्स के अंदर फाइल करेंगे. और उसके लिए नेम अप्रूवल पहले फाइल करना इंपॉर्टेंट है अगर हम चेंज इन नेम चाहते हैं तो, कि ये नेम अवेलेबल है. और ऐसा कोई चेंज अगर हम कर लेते हैं जब तक हम इसको रजिस्टर नहीं करते, यानी कि जब तक हम इसको एनसीए के साथ फाइल नहीं करते और वहां से अप्रूवल ना आ जाए, तब तक दीज चेंजेस विल नॉट टेक एनी काइंड ऑफ एन इफेक्ट. अब अगर मैं ऑल्टरेशन इन मेमोरेंडम ऑफ एसोसिएशन की बात करूं, तो उस पर स्टैम्प ड्यूटी की पेमेंट है या नहीं? भाई मेरे एक्ट के अंदर यानी कंपनीज एक्ट के अंदर कोई न्यू मेमोरेंडम ऑफ एसोसिएशन पे मेरे को कुछ पे करने की जरूरत नहीं है. Under the Companies Act, this is not required to be paid. This is under the Stamp Duty Act of the relevant state. So stamp is the subject of the relevant statute of that particular company. अब जैसे मेरा Stamp Duty Act है, दिल्ली का अलग है, गुजरात का अलग है, पंजाब का of course अलग है. So whatever is applicable, अगर मेरी company का authorized share capital मैं बढ़ा रही हूँ और authorized share capital के हिसाब से मेरे को और stamp duty pay करनी है, तो मेरे को वो pay करनी पड़ेगी. Company का merger कर रही हूँ, मर्जर की वजह से मेरी शेयर कैपिटल बढ़ रही है, अदर शेयर कैपिटल मेरे को बढ़ानी पड़ रही है, वहां पर अगर मेरे को एक्स्ट्रा स्टैम्प ड्यूटी पे करनी है बाय वर्चू ऑफ इंक्रीज इन द अदर शेयर कैपिटल ऑफ माय कंपनी, देन आई हैव टू पे. बट बिकॉज आई एम इंक्रीजिंग माय पेड अप शेयर कैपिटल, आई डोंट नीड टू पे दिस. माय कंपनीज एक्ट डज नॉट टॉक अबाउट दिस सब्जेक्ट एट ऑल. आई विल हैव टू, फॉर द रेलेवेंसी ऑफ दिस पर्टिकुलर टॉपिक, for the relevancy of the purpose of the stamp duty, I will have to go on to my stamp duty act of my relevant state and accordingly take a decision. Whether company can alter its subscription clause? No. The subscriber sheet cannot be changed. For example, recently a company ka hum logon ne public se private kara tha. Of course, the reason maine aapko shuruaat mein bataya ki ji dematerialization of shares was required. कन्वर्जन के लिए एप्लीकेशन डाल दी जी, कंपनी ने ये रेजोल्यूशन पास कर दिया है तो मेरे को करने की जरूरत ही नहीं है. ऑल्टर्ड एओए, ऑल्टर्ड एमओए, लास्ट पेज क्या था? मेरा सब्सक्राइबर शीट जो कि मैंने इनकॉर्पोरेशन के टाइम बनाया था, इनकॉर्पोरेशन के टाइम जो साइन हुआ था वही लगेगी. बट हाँ, वही आप नाम आप लिखकर एसडी कर सकते हो, एसडी लिख सकते हो. व्हाई? बिकॉज़ द ओरिजिनल इज ऑलरेडी फाइल्ड विद द एमसीए एट द टाइम ऑफ इनकॉर्पोरेशन. So during the lifespan of the company, it can never be altered. Some people go and say ki nahi, ab mere ye wala member to zinda raha nahi. This is a deceased member who had signed the subscriber sheet. So can I have another member to sign it? Sorry sir, that is not possible. Which companies need prior approval for making changes in object clause? Agar aapki koi architecture company hui, banking company hui, mutual fund company hui, MLM company hui, स्टॉक ब्रोकर हुआ, तो जो आपके रेलिवेंट रेगुलेटर्स हैं जो कि अंडर स्टैट्यूट आपको रेगुलेट करते हैं, तो आपको उनका प्रायर अप्रूवल चाहिए होगा व्हेन यू आर ऑल्टरिंग द ऑब्जेक्ट क्लॉज ऑफ योर कंपनी इन द मेमोरेंडम ऑफ एसोसिएशन. नाउ आई वुड कम टू द लास्ट सेगमेंट. दिस इज स्लाइटली लेंथी एज कम्पेयर टू द अदर टॉपिक्स वी हैव डन, कन्वर्जन ऑफ पब्लिक लिमिटेड कंपनी इनटू प्राइवेट लिमिटेड. नाउ बिफोर आई गो इनटू दिस पर्टिकुलर प्रोसेस, before I get into the complete process, I have a quick question for all of you. How many of you have already undertaken this particular process for any of your clients? How many of you have already undertaken this process for any of your clients? I'm quickly awaiting a response in the chat box, please. I have 172 members here. So of course, with 172 members already here, I would be willing to know how many have undertaken. All right. So I have two responses coming from Jignashu Shah and Munish Shah. So these two persons who have undertaken this particular type of transaction for their client companies already. चलो आपसे मेरा एक और क्वेश्चन आता है. ओके स्नेह शाह एज वेल, आप तीनों से कोई ऐसा पॉइंट लगा कि यार ये डिफिकल्टी है ही है, ये मैंडेटरी करना ही है. दैट्स मिस्टर अमित चौधरी आल्सो हु इज जॉइंड इन द सेम लीग. सो फोर पीपल आउट ऑफ 171, बिकॉज 172nd इज माई सेल्फ. सो फोर आउट ऑफ 171 स्टेट दैट वी अंडरटेकन दिस प्रोसेस फॉर आवर क्लाइंट्स. What were the basic reasons that you undertook this particular transaction? Aap charo, maybe one by one, you can unmute yourself and share it. Maybe Jignashu ji first. Jignashu ji, followed by Monish ji, then Ms. Sneh and Mr. Amit. or maybe you could share it via in the chat box as to what propagated or what propelled you to undertake this kind of a conversion of a public limited company into a private limited company. Why? Because जिसके अंदर मतलब एक मेरे को ये classic example भी इसलिए लग रहा है because मेरा articles भी alter हो रहे हैं, मेरे MOA भी alter हो रहा है. इसके अंदर तो पूरा process मेरा cover हो ही जाएगा. But आपने क्यों करवाया अपने client का, आप वो एक बार share करिए. मैं क्यों recommend कर रही हूँ वो अलग है. Okay, it is a silent company. So basically nothing is happening in the company. It is a silent bolne ke bajaye Jignashu, probably I should use the word, it is a dormant company in terms of how it is, but not yet registered as a dormant company. So isliye humne socha ki bhai isko convert karke public limited se private limited kar dein. That is the understanding I get out of your message. Monish ji, Sneha ji and Amit ji, could we have you sharing your inputs as well? Because that enriches, see, me giving a particular viewpoint is different. When you share your practical experience with those who know you personally, probably through the Ahmedabad platform, they would be able to understand it equally well. And probably that's how the connectivity between the members here would also increase. So the other three members who had shared, if you would like to share as to why did you give this or suggest it as an option to your particular client? All right, so what I'll do is, let me give them time at this particular moment and they could probably type it back and same issue was there. So they decided to convert to private limited. Same issue as mine or same issue as Jignashu ji? Because I think dematerialization has been off late the most important reason. Jignashu ji, okay, silent company ka case tha. To inhone Manish ji ne bhi apne client ko suggest kiya ji ki aap public se private mein aa jao. अच्छा काफी केसेस ऐसे tax benefit भी है ठीक है okay that I think Manish ji, you guys forming part of the chartered accountant fraternity would be able to price that better. Now let me share कि मैं जो personally अगर मैं भी अपने client को ये advice कर रही होती हूँ, obviously clients do come to me as an advocate, they have come to me as a company secretary when I was a practicing CS for 7.5 years close to before I took up advocacy. So we used to sit together, my husband is a practicing CA, Vikas ji knows him well as well. So I sit with him कि भाई tax benefit क्या है. तो I think इस चीज पे अगर कुछ होगा तो आप लोग मुझे better बता सकते हो. And I would admit that. Now, when I talk about the process, again ये बोला जाए तो बहुत complex process है. क्यों? क्योंकि हमें relevant laws पढ़ने पड़ेंगे, हमें secretarial standards पढ़ने पड़ेंगे, उसके बाद हम process बनाएंगे, फिर याद आएगा इसमें से कुछ छूट गया. तो process ही discuss कर लेते हैं, better रहेगा. 11-12 steps का है. First, मेरी कंपनी को बोर्ड मीटिंग कन्वीन करनी पड़ेगी और कुछ आइटम्स अप्रूव करने पड़ेंगे उसकी बोर्ड मीटिंग के अंदर. और उसके लिए आई नीड टू सेंड नोटिस टू द डायरेक्टर्स ऑफ माय कंपनी दैट देयर इज अ बोर्ड मीटिंग फॉर व्हिच दिस पर्टिकुलर एजेंडा इज लिस्टेड एंड दिस पर्टिकुलर एजेंडा नीड्स टू बी अप्रूव्ड सो दैट फर्दर एक्शन कैन बी अंडरटेकन. नाउ दिस शुड नोटिस हैज टू बी सेंड नॉट लेस देन 7 days बिफोर द मीटिंग. यानी कि 7 दिन का कम से कम एक गैप होना चाहिए बिटवीन माय बोर्ड मीटिंग एंड the notice date on which the board meeting notice was sent. Now, when I talk about this, there may be two more conditions. One, I need to send a shorter consent. If there is a shorter consent, my board of directors should ratify that shorter consent. Or just company mein independent directors hain, independent director ko bhi wo consent ko ratify karna padega. Second case, entrenched articles hain. Entrenched articles kya hain? Entrenched articles hain, yani ki stricter than Companies Act 2013. अब अगर ऐसा भी केस है और लिखा है जी जस्ट लाइक फॉर वन ऑफ आवर क्लाइंट्स व्हिच इज अ स्टार्टअप, सो व्हाट इज दैट दे हैव अ 10 डेज नोटिस फॉर बोर्ड मीटिंग्स, वी विल हैव टू कंप्लाई विद द 10 डेज नोटिस फॉर द बोर्ड मीटिंग्स बिकॉज अदरवाइज मेरे इंटरेस्ट आर्टिकल्स को मैं वायलेट कर दूंगी अंडर सेक्शन 173(3). सो माय बोर्ड मीट फॉर द बोर्ड मीटिंग नीड्स टू बी कन्वीन्ड फॉर दिस द रिक्वायर्ड गैप has to be followed for the purpose of sending of the notice or service of notice, if I say correctly, service of notice of the board meeting to my directors of the company. Now, if this is undertaken, my company has to convene and hold this particular board meeting जहाँ पर कुछ specific items को उन्होंने consider करना है और approve करना है. अब वो specific items क्या हैं? अब अगर मैं सबसे पहला item बात करूँ, एक proposal जाएगा कि भाई convert करो मेरी public company को private company में. Second, for amendment of my memorandum and articles, because जब मेरा memorandum कहेगा जी say ABC limited, it has to change to ABC private limited. My articles of association would talk about minimum number of directors. Then my articles of association would talk about कि भाई public limited के case में maximum number of members में इतने हैं और नहीं है public में, और private में मेरे को limit करना पड़ेगा 200 पे. तो changes like these would have to be undertaken in my process. और इसके लिए भी मेरे को amendment के लिए पहले I'll have to seek an approval from my board members, my board of directors. उसके बाद ये जो अप्रूवल आएगा फॉर अमेंडमेंट ऑफ एमओए एंड एओए सब्जेक्ट टू अप्रूवल बाय द मेंबर्स इन द जनरल मीटिंग एंड आरडी की एप्लीकेशन. सो दैट वेज इट हैज टू फॉलो दिस पर्टिकुलर प्रोसेस कि यहाँ पर आई एम अप्रूविंग दिस अमेंडमेंट बट सब्जेक्ट टू अप्रूवल बाय द मेंबर्स इन द स्पेशल बाय वे ऑफ स्पेशल रेजोल्यूशन इन माई जनरल मीटिंग एंड बाय द रीजनल डायरेक्टर देयर आफ्टर. मेरी एसआर जैसे ही पास हो जाएगा, एसआर के बाद मेरे को इसको फाइल करके आरडी से भी अप्रूवल लेना है. देन आई हैव टू ऑथराइज अ डायरेक्टर और एनी अदर पर्सन who's eligible कि भाई इस पर्पज से रिलेटेड जितना भी काम है, इस प्रपोजल से रिलेटेड जितना काम है, जितने डॉक्यूमेंटेशन है, उसके लिए हम आपको ऑथराइज कर रहे हैं. यू कैन अंडरटेक साइनिंग ऑफ द डॉक्यूमेंटेशन, यू कैन अंडरटेक से ड्राफ्टिंग ऑफ द रिक्विजिट पेपर्स एंड डॉक्यूमेंटेशन एज वेल. कस्तूरी, आई टेक योर क्वेश्चन इन अ वाइल. नेक्स्ट, इसी के अंदर और रेजोल्यूशन क्या है? मेरे को जनरल मीटिंग कॉल करनी है क्योंकि मेरे को एसआर पास करना है, तो उसका नोटिस भी मेरे को इसी में प्रूव करना पड़ेगा. देन मेरे को एक ऑफिसर ऑफ द कंपनी को डेजिग्नेट करना पड़ेगा कि वो लिस्ट ऑफ क्रेडिटर्स बनाए, लिस्ट ऑफ डिवेंचर होल्डर्स बनाए, जो कि मेरे को अगर एप्लीकेशन आरडी पे फाइल करनी है, उस एप्लीकेशन से मैक्सिमम 30 दिन पुरानी, विद इन टाइम फ्रेम ऑफ 30 डेज प्रायर टू फाइलिंग ऑफ द एप्लीकेशन विद द आरडी. अब इसके अंदर क्या क्या, बिकॉज माई क्रेडिटर हैव टू गिव अ एनओसी कि भाई वी डू नॉट हैव एन ऑब्जेक्शन इन केस ऑफ द कंपनी गोज ऑन टू चेंज इटसेल्फ फ्रॉम अ पब्लिक लिमिटेड कंपनी टू बीइंग अ प्राइवेट लिमिटेड कंपनी. सो व्हाट ऑल डू आई हैव टू गेट कंसीडर्ड इन दिस? नेम एंड एड्रेस ऑफ एवरी क्रेडिटर, एवरी डिबेंचर होल्डर, अमाउंट्स ड्यू टू देम इन रिस्पेक्ट ऑफ देयर डेट क्लेम लायबिलिटीज. नाउ इसके लिए पता, दिस इज वेरी सिमिलर टू व्हाट हैपेंस एट द टाइम ऑफ मर्जर ऑफ कंपनीज या अमलगमेशन ऑफ कंपनीज. दोनों कंपनीज के डेटर्स और क्रेडिटर्स को लिस्ट जाती है, स्पेसिफिक लेटर्स जाते हैं कि भाई ऐसे ऐसे कंपनी का ये प्रपोजल है, इसको हम एप्लीकेशन फाइल कर रहे हैं, आपका ये डेट है, आपका इतना अमाउंट ड्यू है ऑन अकाउंट ऑफ आर बिजनेस ट्रांजैक्शन, ऑन अकाउंट ऑफ अ लोन एटसेट्रा एटसेट्रा, एंड दे हैव टू सबमिट देयर. इन केस इफ यू डू नॉट हैव, इन केस इफ यू हैव एन ऑब्जेक्शन टू दिस, रेज इट इन दिस फॉर्मेट. इन केस इफ यू डू नॉट हैव एन ऑब्जेक्शन टू दिस, सेंड अस अ साइंड कॉपी ऑफ दिस पर्टिकुलर डॉक्यूमेंट विद इन सो मेनी डेज. कस्तूरी नांडा जी, आई हैव रिसीव्ड योर क्वेश्चन. सब्सिक्वेंट टू कंप्लीशन ऑफ दिस पर्टिकुलर प्रोसीजर विच वी आर डिस्कसिंग, आई वुड टेक अप योर क्वेश्चन एंड फॉर श्योर आंसर द सेम. नाउ अगर कोई कंटिंजेंट या अनअसर्टेन डेट है, उसका एस्टिमेशन लेके उसको भी नोटिफाई करना पड़ेगा. फॉर एग्जाम्पल, अब इसमें कंटिंजेंट में क्या आ जाएगा या अनअसर्टेन में क्या आ जाएगा, मेरा कोई लीगल मैटर चल रहा है, कंटिंजेंट लाइबिलिटी जो कि हम फुटनोट में देते हैं बैलेंस शीट की, as far as I recollect, तो you guys can tell me that better. तो वो जो footnote वाला contingent liability आता है, मैंने अगर ये legal case हार गई तो मेरी company को कितना पैसा pay करना पड़ जाएगा, उस estimation के हिसाब से मेरे को अलग से एक note डालना पड़ेगा. And in that particular manner, once we have these particular data, मैंने इसको collate करने के लिए, इस data को बनाने के लिए किसी को authorize कर दिया है, officer of the company को. Step 3. इसमें मेरा स्टेप 3 जाता है कि मेरे को नोटिस भेजना है मेंबर्स ऑफ द कंपनी को कि भाई वी आर हैविंग अ जनरल मीटिंग ऑफ द कंपनी एंड दीज आइटम्स विच आर टू बी पास्ड बाय मोड ऑफ स्पेशल रेजोल्यूशन आर लिस्टेड इन दिस पर्टिकुलर मीटिंग. अब इसके अंदर 21 डेज क्लियर नोटिस, बट हम क्या कहते हैं जी, 2 दिन भेजने के और 2 दिन मिलने के, तो 25 दिन का नोटिस होना चाहिए. बट मेरा सेक्रेटरियल स्टैंडर्ड इसमें एक पॉइंट और कहता है. सेक्रेटरियल स्टैंडर्ड स्टेट्स दैट इन केस इफ प्रायर टू द मीटिंग आई रिसीव कंसेंट ऑफ 95% ऑफ द मेंबर्स, सो आई कैन undertake a general meeting at a shorter consent, a shorter time limit as well. So I can do it with a, say, 48 hours gap. I can do it with a 24 hours gap. Say I'm just, I know my number of members is 7. Sare ghar ke members hain. Mere ko abhi aaj maine board meeting kari hai. Mere ko kal general meeting karni hai. 7 to 7 members ko maine aaj hi hand deliver karke notice bhijwaye. Sab ne mere ko wahi pe sign kar diya. Notice received, consent approved, shorter consent approved. My meeting can happen next day because 95% of my members have given a prior consent. So prior consent is required in case if I'm going for a shorter time period than clear 21 days. So 21 when I'm excluding the दो दिन जाने का और दो दिन रिसीव होने का. अब स्टेप 4, मेरे को ये जनरल मीटिंग कन्वीन करनी है, कंडक्ट करनी है और उसके अंदर ऑल्टर करने हैं मेमोरेंडम एंड आर्टिकल्स ऑफ एसोसिएशन ऑफ द कंपनी टू कंसीडर द प्रपोजल ऑफ कन्वर्जन ऑफ पब्लिक टू प्राइवेट, अप्रूवल ऑफ अमेंडमेंट ऑफ मेमोरेंडम आर्टिकल्स. अब पिछले में लिखा था सब्जेक्ट टू अप्रूवल बाय द मेंबर्स ऑफ द कंपनी बाय स्पेशल रेजोल्यूशन एंड आरडी अप्रूवल. यहां पे हम लिखेंगे कि भाई जब हम अप्रूव कर ही रहे हैं एज मेंबर्स तो सब्जेक्ट टू अप्रूवल बाय द आरडी एज वेल. And then authorizing a director to undertake all activities for this particular purpose. ये हो गया तो मैं MGT 14 file करूँगी special resolution की copy के साथ, notice और explanatory statement के साथ और altered MOA, altered AOA submit करना है. इसके बाद application draft होगी जो कि RD को जाएगी. Regional director का approval अभी pending है. So regional director के लिए under Rule 41(2) of Companies and Corporation Rules, I will draft an application for conversion from public to private. क्या जाएगा? डेट ऑफ मीटिंग जिसमें प्रपोजल कंसिडर हुआ था, डेट ऑफ जनरल मीटिंग जिसके अंदर ऑल्टरेशन अप्रूव किया गया था बाय माय मेंबर्स, रीजन क्या है कन्वर्जन करने का, उस कन्वर्जन का इफेक्ट क्या आएगा मेरे शेयर होल्डर्स पे, क्रेडिटर्स पे, डिबेंचर होल्डर्स पे, डिपॉजिट होल्डर्स पे, रिलेटेड पार्टीज पे. कोई और कन्वर्जन पिछले 5 साल में हुआ उसकी कॉपी, उसका ऑर्डर की कॉपी. अगर कंपनी सेक्शन 8 कंपनी है तो उसकी डिटेल्स. अब इसमें क्या जाएगा, मेरे लाइसेंस की कॉपी चली जाएगी, मेरे इनकॉर्पोरेशन सर्टिफिकेट की कॉपी चली जाएगी. देन these particular major documentation shall accompany the part of this application which is made to the RD1 ke andar ye file ho and uske baad approval aana hai. Ab ye jo mere creditors ki details aa rahi hai jiske humne authorize kiya tha ek officer ko, is application ke sath wo list of debenture holders, creditors ki list, jitna amount unka payable hai, koi contingent ya unassigned debt hai uski detail, और एक एफिडेविट बनेगा जिसमें माय ऑथराइज्ड ऑफिसर जिसने ये लिस्ट बनाई है वो फाइल करेगा कि भाई ये मेरा कंपनी सेक्रेटरी है, ये मेरे दो डायरेक्टर्स हैं, या अगर मैनेजिंग डायरेक्टर तो मैनेजिंग डायरेक्टर खुद साइन करेगा कि भाई यही लिस्ट है मेरे क्रेडिटर्स की, और वो लिस्ट भी इस एप्लीकेशन के साथ फाइल होगी टू दी रीजनल डायरेक्टर जो कि जिसके पास हमारी ज्यूरिस्डिक्शन पड़ती है. उसके बाद INC 25A जो फॉर्म है उसके अंदर RD application से पहले उस format के हिसाब से I will have to go to the local newspaper of the company जो कि उस state के अंदर जहाँ registered office of the company है वहाँ पे एक newspaper advertisement करना है मेरे को vernacular language में, English language में. For example, if I'm talking about Ahmedabad, I will talk about Gujarati and I will talk about English. If I'm talking about Delhi, I will talk about English and Hindi. If I'm talking about Rajasthan, I talk about say Rajasthani, whichever script is applicable. For example, अगर मैं मारवाड़ी की बात करूं तो मारवाड़ी लैंग्वेज एंड इंग्लिश, सो व्हाटएवर इज द वर्नाकुलर लैंग्वेज ऑफ दैट पर्टिकुलर डिस्ट्रिक्ट. देन एक नोटिस की कॉपी जो कि हर डिबेंचर होल्डर हर क्रेडिटर को जानी, विच आई सेड की लेटर आता है स्पेसिफिक में कि अगर आप को ऑब्जेक्शन है तो इस फॉर्मेट में दो, ऑब्जेक्शन नहीं है तो इसमें हमें साइन करके दे दो. सेकेंड, रजिस्टर्ड पोस्ट विद एक्नॉलेजमेंट ड्यू, अगेन RPAD जिसको हम बोलते हैं, नोटिस टू द रीजनल डायरेक्टर एंड रजिस्ट्रार, और अगर किसी रेगुलेटरी बॉडी के अंडर हम रजिस्टर्ड हैं, फॉर एग्जाम्पल अगर हम इंश्योरेंस कंपनी हैं, अगर हम बैंकिंग कंपनी हैं एक्सेट्रा, सो या फिर स्टॉक ब्रोकर फॉर्म हैं, म्यूचुअल फंड हैं, सो उस रेगुलेटरी बॉडी के पास भी हमारे इस नोटिस की कॉपी चली जानी चाहिए. और उसके बाद RD1 में एप्लीकेशन करने के लिए मेरे को किसी को ऑथराइज करने के लिए फिर से एक बोर्ड मीटिंग कर लेनी पड़ेगी आफ्टर पब्लिशिंग दिस, जिससे कि मेरी RD1 की एप्लीकेशन चली जा सके अलॉन्ग विद ऑल ऑफ दिस. अब वंस दिस इज डन, RD1 का अप्रूवल आ गया, मेरे को GNL1 फाइल करना है ROC के साथ. अब इसमें क्या होगा, एप्लीकेशन मेरी RD को भी चली गई, एप्लीकेशन मेरी ROC को भी चली गई, क्योंकि RD सबसे पहले ROC के पास जाएगा और बोलेगा एक रिपोर्ट बना के दो. तो इसलिए दे से इट इज एडवाइजेबल कि जिसने आपकी रिपोर्ट बनानी है कन्वर्जन के टाइम के लिए ROC, उसको इंटीमेशन होनी चाहिए कि भाई कंपनी इज कंसिडरिंग conversion from a public limited to a private limited company. अब RD1 के कंटेंट्स, जनरल मीटिंग की डिटेल, क्या मिनट्स होंगे, रेजोल्यूशन की कॉपी होगी, अटेंडेंस शीट होगी, कितने लोगों ने फेवर में वोट करा, कितने ने अगेंस्ट में वोट करा, उसकी डिटेल, स्पेशल रेजोल्यूशन जो गया था उसकी कॉपी, नोटिस जनरल मीटिंग का जो हुआ था उसकी कॉपी, ड्राफ्ट कॉपी ऑफ MOA AOA और उसके अंदर जो अल्टरेशंस होने हैं उसकी कॉपी, देन मेरा जो डायरेक्टर है उसकी एफिडेविट कि भाई दिस एंटायर डॉक्यूमेंट हैज बीन अंडरटेकन बाय हिम ऑन बिहाफ ऑफ द कंपनी, देन मेमोरेंडम ऑफ अपीयरेंस अगर एक चार्टर्ड अकाउंटेंट अपीयर कर रहा है, कंपनी सेक्रेटरी अपीयर कर रहा है, कॉस्ट अकाउंटेंट अपीयर कर रहा है, या अगर कोई लॉयर आपने अपॉइंट कर रखा है, एडवोकेट अपॉइंट कर रखा है, तो उसका वकालतनामा और उसके साथ एप्लीकेशन टू दी RD, और क्या जाएगा, कोई रेजोल्यूशन पेंडिंग नहीं है, कंपनी कभी स्टॉक एक्सचेंज पे लिस्टेड नहीं थी, किसी भी लिस्ट ऑफ क्रेडिटर्स डिबेंचर होल्डर्स अटैच्ड हैं, लिस्ट ऑफ क्रेडिटर्स डिबेंचर होल्डर्स वेरीफाइड हैं, उसका एफिडेविट, देन पोर्ट रेजोल्यूशन जो कंपनी ने फाइल करा था अलॉन्ग विद अ कॉपी ऑफ द MGT 14 और उसका चलान, सो ये स्पेसिफिक डॉक्यूमेंटेशन जब जाएगी इसके साथ आपका RD1 की एप्लीकेशन कंप्लीट मानी जाएगी। अब इसके बाद INC 27 में हम फर्दर एक एप्लीकेशन देंगे और उसके अंदर हम कॉपीज ऑफ ऑल्टर्ड MOA AOA RD ऑर्डर और स्पेशल रेजोल्यूशन की कॉपी करके फिर जो ऑर्डर आएगा उसको हम INC 28 में फाइल करेंगे तो हमारा प्रोसेस कंप्लीट हो जाएगा। विद दैट आई हैव अंडरटेकन दी स्पेसिफिक्स विच आई वॉज टू अंडरटेक ड्यूरिंग दिस पर्टिकुलर सेशन। Queries are welcome. And with this,
there is one query
which was shared by Ms. Kasturi Dhanda.
Yeah.
What is the treatment of shares issued to directors in private limited company, whether it is private placement or right shares? Ma'am, right issue करोगे तो आपको सबको issue करना पड़ेगा। आपको सबको एक ऑप्शन देना पड़ेगा कि मेरी कंपनी में आप फर्दर शेयर्स ले लो, ये स्पेसिफिक प्राइस है जो हम सब एग्जिस्टिंग मेंबर्स को ऑफर कर रहे हैं। तो अगर आपने ऐसा कोई ऑफर करा है जो कि इस डायरेक्टर को भी गया है, हु इज आल्सो शेयर होल्डर ऑफ द कंपनी एंड द अदर शेयर होल्डर्स हैव आल्सो रिसीव्ड इट, देन इट इज अ केस ऑफ अ राइट इशू, अदरवाइज इट इज अ केस ऑफ अ प्राइवेट प्लेसमेंट, कुड बी अ प्रेफरेंशियल इशू आल्सो डिपेंडिंग ऑन व्हाट टर्म्स एंड कंडीशंस यू अंडरटेकन, एंड नो इशू ऑफ राइट शेयर्स आर देयर टू एनी अदर शेयर होल्डर्स एट दैट पॉइंट ऑफ टाइम, no other shareholders, then in that case I would say it is a private placement or a preferential issue depending on the TNC that is associated with it. Any subsequent questions?
If anybody has any questions, please either can ask us and we'll unmute you or...
Manish ji, you are slightly not audible properly, just give me a
Now am I audible?
It'll take me 30 seconds.
Am I audible now?
Yes, absolutely.
Okay, so if anybody has any queries, then please put it across or can raise their hands and we can unmute them as well. Sir, any questions or I think ma'am, you were so lucid that almost all the questions have been answered. So on behalf of the Ahmedabad branch of the WIRC of ICI, I thank you so much for giving us this valuable update and also explaining it in such a lucid manner that almost each and everyone was so clear in the subject as well. And now I'm sure that the alteration of MOA and AOA will be as easy as it can be. So thank you, ma'am. And thank you all the participants for such a patient and a great session today. Thank you, everyone. Thank you so much.